I'm going to spend a little time to you ministering in the things of the Spirit for the sole purpose of you moving with the Spirit. Let me just tell you about the dynamics of it. In a Holy Ghost Pentecostal church, what we're waiting for is the people who've already been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire to move. If we were in a church tonight where there was no Pentecostal fire or very little of it, where people did not know how to flow in the anointing, they did not know how to operate in the things of the Spirit, they didn't know how to receive what God has freely given, they're in sickness or in disease and needed a miracle, I'm going to tell you right now, it's not a lot of preaching, it's really just a lot of ministering, and the preaching is the ministering. But here in this context, you are supposed to be a minister and a priest before the presence of the Lord, in whom the Spirit of the Lord can move through, but you've got to learn how to be yielded. And so tonight, I'm just going to take you through some things that some of you have heard many times, but you've never understood how to function in it. So let God open up your eyes. The Spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of the Lord is here. God will not force your will. He's just going to, you're going to have to move with Him. Hallelujah. And it's just a pleasure. I mean, I pray in the name of Jesus, every one of you move with Him. We'll just watch what, let's just watch what God will do. Let's just watch what God will do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So many people live in expectation. Their expectation and the way they prognosticate into the future is based on everything that they've done up to this point. And it's a prison for you. It's a prison of your mind. It's a prison of everything that you have in potential of walking with God. You're going to have to start moving in something so wonderful. It's called faith. Hallelujah. Ha-ha. It's the outworking of the Holy Spirit in the lives of people just desperate for God. And let me just say this too, because I know that some of you here tonight, you weren't here in the morning meeting. And I just want to say thank you so much for that. Those of you who are participating in 21 day fast with us, I mean, it's going into the 16th day. This is the home stretch. Praise God. This is the last leg. Hallelujah. Of 21 days. It's not that difficult. It really isn't. Ha. Hallelujah. After you get used to it for a while. Praise God. It's so good. Just, and especially the first year, if people want to just carry everything, I mean, it would be bad enough if people only carried 2016 and all of their events and all of their issues and all their problems and all of their doubts and all their unbeliefs and all their sin and all of their failing into 2017. Unfortunately, they carry it all the way back to as far as what date they were born kind of thing, And We want to teach you how to think different. We want to teach you how to think different. If we can teach you how to think different, you're going to act different. When we teach you how to think different, you're going to begin to move in an entirely different expectation. Now, if we did that in the natural, it would bring great change for you. But if we do it now in the supernatural, we do it in the realms of the spiritual after that divine empowerment of God, watch out. This is going to get really, really good. And so all you got to do is just listen and then rely upon the Holy Ghost, because having begun in the Holy Spirit, you didn't take it from here or from there. True. Having begun in the Holy Spirit, He didn't turn the job over to you and say, okay, now you finish it up. Huh? Having begun in the Spirit, you now made perfect and mature by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus not only authored your salvation and authored your faith, He is the finisher of it. He didn't author it and say, okay, let me see how good you guys can run with the program. Let me see you can really take this thing and develop it into something great. He authored it, did the great, finished it. Hallelujah. And let me just tell you, the one who began a good work in you isn't waiting to see how you thrash about and figure it out and make it all happen and put it all together. The one who began a good work in you shall complete it.
Amen.
And if I could just get you to think different, Amen. You'll start speaking different. Amen. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And out of the abundance of heart, your mouth will speak. And if I can just get you to shut yourself down and start preaching the word to yourself, speaking the word, some people say, oh, we're concerned about, especially you go into a strange area, a religious area, not like a foreign country where there's nothing but Buddhists or Hindus or Muslims or whatever. But in the Western world, well, how do you know that the person's not a false prophet? Everybody's got this false prophet scare going on. Listen, I'll tell you, let me calm you down. You're the worst false prophet that you know. To yourself. to yourself. And if anybody else believed the doctrine that you live, my goodness, we'd all be messed up. So we want to stop that. We want to shut that down so you never speak another thing to yourself other than the Word of God. You start prophesying. You start speaking by the Spirit. God, the Holy Spirit's never going to say anything but the Word. You want me to give you some discernment tonight so you can know whether it's God, the Holy Ghost, or you? Or worse than that, you know, the realms of darkness. If it isn't the Word of God, it's not the Spirit of truth. It's not what He's saying. You got yourself some discernment here tonight. Hallelujah. You got yourself some discernment. And the beautiful thing of it is when you start living this way, then, oh, my Father then is allowed to kick in the gift of the discerning of spirits and begin to do some things to your life of building you up in faith. And, you know, if you've ever heard me preach on faith, faith is so easy. Faith is easy, 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 easy. Okay? And, you know, it's so sad, you know, that always, you know, Jesus saying to the disciples that left everything and followed him, saying, you got little faith, micro faith, you know, little faith or no faith at all. I mean, that's what he's saying to them. But he looks at this woman who comes, who's not even a candidate for salvation, who he's not even sent to. And she shows us the transition from no faith to little faith to great faith. And it's so simple. All you got to do is look and see. All she did was she was unwilling to take no for an answer. And she fell down and worshiped him. You know, that's it. And he looks at this and he goes, this is great faith. This is what I'm looking for. Centurion shows us as well. I'm a man of authority. I recognize who you are. I recognize your authority. All you've got to do is speak the word only. He said, I've not found such faith in all of Israel, not among my disciples. He's looking at Peter. I've not found any kind of, what's wrong with you guys? I mean, you know, he over and again, the Lord did everything he possibly could do to allow them, his people, his disciples, especially those that are closest to them, him, to encounter the realms of the spiritual, to encounter the realms of heaven, in other words, they're synonyms, to encounter the realms of the spirit, all synonyms, those are all equal. Those terms are primarily equated in our interface with God today, okay? And then when they would not be willing to allow those events to set their expectation for the future, he would say, you faithless and perverse generation, how long do I got to put up with you? He said, are you so hard-hearted? Have you yet your heart hardened that you cannot even discern? Can't you even remember? Don't you know what just happened? I took seven loaves and two, and you took seven loaves and two fishes. You did it. I handed it to you, and you fed 5,000 men, not counting women and children, took up 12. How many baskets did you take up? You know, he didn't tell them how many he took up. He asked, how many baskets? You took up 12. Yeah. But they wouldn't allow his working, his power, his word, his manifested glory to change their expectation. They wouldn't allow God in all that he was doing to change the way that they were thinking. Amen. He would talk about, oh, we need to be renewed in the spirit of our mind, like it's the fourth work of grace. I mean, we would talk about Wesley, that he, and Wesleyanism, oh, there's two works of grace, you know, salvation and sanctification, you know, they're way off. Well, you probably got four or five works of grace. If we sorted out your doctrine and the dogma that you live by, man, it happened for us in Christ Jesus. We were renewed in the spirit of our mind. And in fact, it is when you think about renewed in the spirit of your mind in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 23, or whether you look at it in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, really in layman's terminology, if it's Koine Greek, and Koine Greek is not the, you know, the aristocratic Greek language. It is the street language. And so it literally means to stop thinking the way you think. Start thinking different. Start thinking different. Start thinking different. Yes. To be renewed in the spirit of mind, it's just start thinking different. The Lord says he gives us all of these things, Ephesians. And of course, you know, those of you who've been around me, you know, long enough, you realize where I'm at with Ephesians, okay? Yeah. And if I start getting Ephesians, I'll just start quoting chapter 1, verse 1, go all the way through. I'll get up to this point because it is so lofty. It's the terminology that the Lord uses. He starts off telling us we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm, but you can't see it. But you can see it if you're willing to have your eyes open. You're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm, but there's got to be an event that takes place. God has done all these wonderful, amazing, immeasurable things for you according to the good pleasure of his own will. He just did it. He just did it. He just wanted to be good to you because he's a great father. He's a good dad. Huh? But you're going to have the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that the eyes of your understanding can be opened so that you can see what's really going on around you, like the servant of Elisha. So you can really see what's taking place over here. Huh? So that you can understand your inheritance in him. No, boo me down, boo me down, boo me down, boo me down. I just quoted the scripture wrong. What's wrong with you folks? God, what's wrong with you people? What's wrong with you people? Don't be so gullible. So that you can, so that your eyes can be open, so that you can see what his inheritance is in you. He's got an inheritance in you, man. He's got an inheritance in you. I mean, I could talk a little bit about it in terms of what you can do right now. Maybe you're going to reach 10,000 souls. Maybe the signs and the wonders and the miracles of the Lord Jesus Christ are going to be fully manifested through your life because you're not willing to hold anything back. He's got an inheritance in you. It's what he wants to do. His inheritance in you is the complete reproduction of the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. Oh, yeah. The multiplication of it. I'm telling you right now. And then to speak of those things which go off into the eternal future, into the everlastings of God. That he's got his inheritance in you and me. The thing that he did when he raised Jesus from the dead, set him his own right hand, far above the principalities and powers and might, and every dominion that is named, every name that is named, every dominion that exists, the exceeding greatness of his power that has been given to you and me. That we have as treasures in this earthen vessel. That the excellency and the glory may be of God, not of you and me. Oh, why don't you just get out of the picture and get into Jesus. Amen. And let him be the full painting of it all about your life. Amen. So you start believing things differently according to what he said. And not according to what you said and what all the people around you said and what circumstance said. I tell you, I know how to see supernatural provision come. You just start thanking God for all that he has provided for you. Amen. And you don't care about anything else but that which he's promised to do. You cast all your cares upon him. You learn how to deal with the assailing thoughts. I'm going to talk to you about that tonight. We're not just going to poke fun at you. Show you your problems and then say neener, neener, neeners. We're going, by the help and the grace of God, give you the tools by which you can now move in the realms of perfect obedience. Hallelujah. Amen. How you can start cooperating with God if you could just see where you allow yourself to walk after the natural thinking and the natural realm, then that day you can now have a discernment to shut it down and say, nope, I was once natural. He that is born of the natural is natural. Huh? But I've been born of the Spirit, and I'm now living in the Spirit and walking in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. And the Word of God's here teaching us. The Holy Spirit's here teaching us. God is instructing us. He's given to us everything that he has in order for us to be able to get it. He changed our heart. He redeemed us. He transformed everything about our lives so that we would be able to understand what's coming out of his mouth, where it wouldn't be like, what on earth are you talking about? Now, the natural man is going to say, what on earth are you talking about? But not the spiritual man, not that one that is born of the Spirit. So the Lord gives to us this ability to grab hold of the reality that here at this very moment in time, you and I can comprehend with all the saints what is the height. Right now, not later, now, right now. Bless the law, spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, eyes open, be able to understand and see the greatness of his power. Understand that we're functioning in the fullness of him that filleth all things, that is his church, to recognize we're seated with him in a heavenly realm, that we're no longer in that realm where the prince and the power of the air, the God of this world, now dominates over our lives, but rather we are dominating because we're seated with Christ Jesus, who's far above all principality, power, and might. I figure I need to talk fast so that you don't get it all said, because this isn't even part of what I want to say. This is Christ. I'm trying to grab you. I'm trying to grab you. God's trying to grab us. He's trying to. Enoch is just doing nothing but saying, hey, guys, this realm really exists. You ought to come over. It is, wow, incredible. That's why he's in the Bible. That's it. That's all that Moses is doing. That's all that Abraham is doing. Guys, this realm really exists. That's all Moses is doing. That's all Elijah is doing. That's all Daniel is doing. We're reading stories. Reading stories. Oh, I wish I was them. I wished I lived in that day. Oh, when the mountain was lit up with the fire of God and God's voice spoke audibly. No, they were wishing that they were in our days. I can see Paul going, I cannot even believe the pathetic state of the church. Let me back in there. Let me, come on. Where is somebody? Is somebody? And Elijah, he's even more poised to be able to return because he gets to come back. He's going, when do I get to go back? When? I can't, look what they're doing down there. This is your glorious church. My. You know, can't you see him? Huh? We are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses right now, believe it or not. You think that everything is in secret and it's all walking around in a blindfolded, dark state, God somewhere far, far away. No. All heaven's looking at you and me going, what? You guys have been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You guys have been endued with the authority to walk in the very ministry of God made flesh, Christ Jesus. Come on now. You got to think different. It's got to start with the way that you eat. It's got to start with the way that you clothe yourself. That's right. Huh? Yes. Got to quit making it a priority. Go after the kingdom and the righteousness that is in the kingdom. The kingdom of God and His righteousness above all things. Got to quit thinking. Got to quit thinking the way you've been thinking. True. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And then we can begin to grab a hold of and comprehend with all the saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ. I mean, the Lord pairs it down in such a simple relational word, a relationship word that must exist between husband and wife. There's various levels, you know, of relationship. Husband and wife, high level, you know, father and sons, father and daughter, mother and sons, mother and daughter, family relationships, you know, church relationships, which is also family. Then the relationship, which is above all, our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, our relationship with the Father, our relationship with God, the Holy Ghost, our recognition of who He is. Many people come to church and they do not consciously recognize that God the Holy Ghost is here and He's in charge and He better be bowed before and He better be listened to and He better be followed. We strip Him of His power and of His authority. We trample all over the anointing and wonder why God's not doing anything.
Amen.
And it's just, the thing's got to change. It's just got to change. Hello. Amen. You have to change. I'm going to tell you, people don't like it because it's not a motivational speaker. I'm not a motivational speaker telling you how wonderful you are and how, you know, just you're going to be able to do everything on your own because you're just, you know, you got it all put together. I'm going to tell you right now in the name of Jesus, you need to change.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. And the beautiful thing of it is, it's not a help, it's self-help program. God is here. The helper has come. Hallelujah. He's come. He's come to help us. He's come to lead us. He's come to guide us. He's come to strengthen us. And not with just a little bit of strength. He's come to give us the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Whoa. I mean, come on. That's a whole lot of divine ability. You talk about, that's a whole lot. That's like El Shaddai, the sovereign one, almighty. That's what it means. El Shaddai means the sovereign, the absolute sovereign of the universe. That's what it means. El Shaddai, the almighty. Huh? And He's come and He's given to us all that He has and the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Now, tell me about your little old problems. Your little old worries, your little old cares that are all wrapped up in your life because of your doubt and unbelief, because you're not willing to speak the word, believe the word. Hallelujah. Confession, all confession is declaration of the Word of God. It's the word of prophecy. It's not some whimsical idea, some asking of fantastical, a thing that you're going to, you know, use according to your own purposes and for your own will. It's being caught away in Father's will to do nothing of ourselves. Father wants to show you tonight. Will you listen?
Yes.
Will you receive? Will you grab a hold of it? Will you just hook up? Will you go? Fasting and prayer, believe it or not, will help you. When the beast starts roaring and you say, not feeding you, I'm going to learn about a different kind of spiritual food. Huh? The lion roars. Huh? Too much serving the belly. Hey, praise God for the food. It's a delight, isn't it? Huh? Some of you haven't eaten for a while. You're going to wait. That first bite is like, whoa. Got to be careful with that first bite, though. Got to go easy. Huh? Food is good. Huh? God is better. There's a divine strength and a divine energy and a divine power, a divine grace. His grace. To be able to do things that are not humanly possible to do. Be able to believe things that are not humanly possible to believe. to be able to interact with his own person, to come into a place where he said to the most holy of men, you cannot come in. Though he loved Moses exceedingly, he said, don't you come near me. Though Moses was willing to obey him and fully separate himself unto him, he said, don't you come near me. Don't you come near me. You can't get any closer. Take off your shoes now. You're on holy ground.
Yes.
That's what he said. Go read it. Exodus chapter 3, don't come near me. Huh?
Yeah.
And now he looks at you and me. He says, come on in.
Yes, amen.
By the blood of Jesus Christ into a new and living way. Hallelujah. With all boldness. He says, come and behold. Come gaze upon me. And we're sitting around all wrapped up in our silly little problems because we're thinking wrong. Because we're dragging all of our baggage of every little offense and every little issue and all the little whatever along with us. Oh, please let me get into your life and bust that loose. Please, that Spirit of the Lord come in and cause you to abhor those things so that they're no longer attached to you.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because then everything changes. As a man thinks in his heart, that's the way it works out for him. That's how it happens in his life. That's what he is. That's the limitations of all that he can do. And God opened up the opportunity for you and I to step into an unlimited realm where you can by the Spirit of the Lord, by the Holy Ghost, not out of your religious routine. There are so many Pentecostals got a religious routine of praying in the Spirit. And it just sounds very different than what Sandy was just doing a few minutes ago and what Jacqueline is doing much of the time when she's in here, and some of you others. You've learned how to connect to that realm. Somebody said, and it's just as miraculous as any other realm, and you learn how to walk in the miracle of it. You learn how to walk in the miracle of healing and signs and wonders. Somebody asked William Branham. They asked Jack Coe. They asked A. Allen. They asked so many different people, how is it that this flow of heaven is so accurate and so powerful, especially with William Branham and the word of knowledge and the gifts of miracles that he had in his life? He said, and the same thing was with same question was asked Smith Wigglesworth. How is it that you flow in this realm of the Spirit so easily? The answer is simple. Stay yielded. How do I stay yielded? I believe what he said. I live in what he said. I walk in the Spirit, which is walking in the Word. Everything that is contrary to the Word of God, I throw it down, I cast it down, I will not allow it in my thinking.
Amen.
I won't allow it.
Amen.
It's not allowed here.
Amen.
People, we're going to be tempted. Jesus was tempted. Not every thought that you have is something that is coming out of your own heart. It's not. Otherwise, you would need a shield of faith to quench the violent, fiery darts of the wicked one. You know, the reality of it is, if there wasn't something outside of you trying to impose itself upon you, there would be no such thing as temptation. We have to learn how to deal with every kind of thought, whether it's doubt thought or immoral thought, unbelief thought, or any kind of wrong thinking. It doesn't matter. Whatever category it is, you've got to learn how to shut it down. And the weapons of your warfare are very powerful to do so.
Amen.
And the bottom line of it is, you and I have got to grab a hold of it living in another realm. So I want to take you and begin to unfold you a little bit of the realms. And I want to get you out of all these crazy nonsensical dogmas that make everything confused. Listen, I want you to understand, and I'm going to take it up from this morning, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Let me ask you a question. What are you?
Spirit.
That is a huge step forward. You took one step out, as it were, almost, in terms of the congregation and the assembly that's all walking in the same, basically, you know, concept of a death row sentence. I'm unrighteous. I'm foreign. I'm alienated. I'm still unclean. I'm still in the flesh. Wait a minute. What are you going to believe? Are you going to believe God's report? I know it's an unspeakable gift. I know the salvation goes beyond anything that you could have ever supplied for yourself. You don't deserve it. You never earned it. And most of the things that you've been taught in a Western culture is that you get rewarded for doing something special. You've earned it. You know, you stood out above the rest of the crowd. No. Father gives this. This belongs to everybody equally, from whether it's Nicodemus, the ruler of the Jew, or if it's the Samaritan woman who's an adulteress. It's all a leveling floor.
Yes.
It's all a gift. Amen. You get to step into it. Huh? But you're going to have to start agreeing with it. And a lot of agreeing with it is for you to begin to speak it out, because your voice is going to become louder in agreement with God than those fleshly lusts that war against your soul.
Amen.
There's something on the outside of you. It's called the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. It's not in you. It's on the outside of you. And if you don't know how to, if you don't know how to draw the battlefront and the battle line, you're never going to be victorious. God wants you and I to function in something. This is the victory that has overcome the world. Even our
faith.
And our faith is something that is a word of confession. It's our word that is in our heart and it's in our mouth. This is the word of faith. This is those things which God said that we are. These are those things which God said he gave to you and me. It's saying, look, you have no idea who you're talking to. You have no idea who you're confronting. I am a son and a daughter of the Most High. I'm one who stepped in the glorious liberty of the sons of God. I go out, and where creation was groaning and travailing, we go out, we led forth in peace, and the mountains and the hills break forth into singing, and all the trees of the fields start clapping their hands. Creation not groaning and travailing there. Creation is now rejoicing. Because the redeemed of the Lord is returning. Come with singing unto Zion. Come with singing unto Zion. Come with singing unto Zion. Come with singing. Come with praise. Come with thanksgiving. A living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. You got to connect the dots here, people. Because there is nothing going to be happening in terms of the outbreaks of the glory of God when you're walking around basically in a realm of murmuring and complaining and doubt and wondering where did you sin? Where did you go wrong? I mean, come on. Satan believes that he owns every human being, that if ultimately he's given an unrestricted access, he can make the most righteous curse God. And that was what Job was all about. Huh? Hallelujah. But look at Job. My goodness. He really was a champion. You know, God doesn't need any champions anymore. The final one came, Christ Jesus, the captain of our salvation. He doesn't really need any more champions. But it would be great if some people start throwing in.
Amen.
It would be great if somebody starts throwing in the abundant life that the champion gave to us. Because if we're living in the champion's life, then we're champions. Amen. Champions in the authority to stand against the powers of darkness, no matter how strong they come at us, no matter what circumstance, no matter what situation comes. I discovered a long time ago, you cannot take people who do not know how to pray out into the streets to minister, to really begin to confront the powers of darkness. You can't take them on the foreign field with you to really confront the powers of darkness, because if you don't have a prayer life, you'll have no strength nor ability to make it through the day. You won't make it through the day. You're going to have a fellowship, a communion, a way to hook up, connect with the divine empowerment that causes you to believe the unseen rather than to believe the seen. We look not on those things which are seen. In other words, our desire is not placed upon what we see. We look not on those things which are seen. Our desires are not there. Our interests are not there. What we believe is going to be taking place or happening right now is not there. But we look on that which is unseen. Our desire is in the realm of the unseen. We cooperate with the unseen by the unseen Holy Ghost. We cooperate with the unseen by the seen Word of God. Hallelujah. Praise God for the seen Word of God. Enoch did a great job and he didn't have no Bible. I said Enoch did a great job and he didn't have no Bible. I said Enoch did a great job and he didn't have the blood of the Lamb, and he wasn't baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, and he did an amazing job, and he's a testimony and a witness to every single one of us. We better get our act together. We better start knowing who we are. The one thing that Enoch knew about Enoch was he knew who he was. He was the sixth from Adam and a servant of the Most High God. And he walked so perfectly before the Lord. He so pleased God. Hallelujah. And we understand without faith it is impossible to please God. And we also know that those who are in the flesh cannot please God.
Amen.
Then you need to change your vocabulary.
Yeah.
No, 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 no. I've taken it in the ribs. I've taken it in the head. I've been stoned by every word that people can throw at me. I've been ostracized. Whole camps of people have gotten up and walked out of me, on me in meetings in the Western world. I've been persecuted on the right hand and on the left hand just because I said, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, so you need to change your vocabulary.
Amen.
I'm going to get to you. Just hang on. I'm gonna, you know, if you don't realize I've already loaded you down with a bunch of scriptures, just wait till we're done. I'm going to have you turn to a bunch of them. I want to live by the word.
Amen.
Man, Jesus is there facing everything that the gates of hell and the power of hell and the leagues of Satan, could throw at him. And he was just throwing them off right, left, and center with Deuteronomy chapter 8. Come on, just quote a Deuteronomy. Somebody said there's no power in the Old Testament. You just quote Deuteronomy and defeat Satan, everything he's going to throw at you. Just wait what happens when you start quoting Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Just wait what happens when you start quoting Ephesians. And start speaking with tongues of fire. My goodness, every power in hell flees away. And if you can see it, if you can begin to see it with the Word of God, with the Spirit of God, it becomes a solidified living reality in your life. People don't see it. They think that they're somehow handicapped and orphaned and left alone and isolated, trying to get God. I had a preacher say to me one time, he said, the heavens are brass to my prayers. I said, first of all, you gotta be kidding me. Did I just hear you say that? Heaven's brass. What if heaven was brass? What if Jesus slammed the door and the Father went and locked, deadbolted and locked it and put a chain on it? And the Holy Ghost is standing guard saying, you can't come here. That's your doctrine? That's your doctrine? Well, just imagine that it was just totally was brass. Where is God right now? He's looking at me like,
in me.
Come on, man. I'm the temple of the living God. Why are you so easily uprooted from these things? We're the dwelling place of the Most High. Jesus said, I will come, and my Father will come, and we will make our abode with you.
Amen.
And on top of that, I'm going to give you the Holy Ghost. He's going to be with you and in you.
Amen.
See, in that day you shall know. In that day. People need to have that day. And I want you to have, if you hadn't had that day, you need to have that day today.
Amen.
I was going to say you need to have that day tonight, but you know, you need to have that day today. Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 17 and 18 and 19 and 20, all the way to verse 24, he gave such enormous amounts of revelation that it seems to me somebody needs to go ahead and grab a hold of it and lay hold on it and believe it and move with God in it. He told us that the Holy Spirit would be with us and in us, and in that day we would know that he is in the Father and that we are in him. Whoa. Wow. That he is in us and that we are in him. Have you had that day? Well, quit forgetting. Quit losing the day. Build a monument somewhere. Build an altar there. Build an altar there. I've had the day. I have had the day that brought to me revelation that Christ Jesus is in the Father, that the Father is in Christ Jesus, and that they are in me and I am in them. I've had that day. Have you read that? Have you anybody read that? People think that's a day in somewhere in the sweet by and by when we all get to heaven. No, we have gotten there.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We're there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We've been translated in the kingdom of dear son. We in his heaven.
Yes.
In the Old Testament, in Deuteronomy chapter 11, you can discover that they could have days of heaven upon the earth just because they were willing to obey God, do what he said to do. Well, if they could have days of heaven on earth, what is it like to have God the Father, God the only begotten Son, Christ Jesus, the eternal Word, and the Holy Ghost on the inside of you? Is that not heaven?
Yes.
and then to be baptized with his glory. Is that not heaven?
Yes, sir.
Was it not heaven when God the Father came down upon the tabernacle in the wilderness with his glory fire and his glory cloud and captivated bug-eyed Joshua with all that he was doing so that Joshua never departed from the tabernacle? Was that heaven?
Yes.
It was heaven. It was heaven. You can live a realm and live a life to where there's very little transition from the time you leave here, breathing out your last breath. To make a transition, not sit there and worry or wonder, but you're so caught up in heaven that you breathe out your last breath, you die in the Lord. And immediately just step over into another realm.
Amen.
As it were. Well, not even another realm. I used the wrong word, sorry. Another dimension. People talk about levels. You can talk about realms. You can talk about dimensions. But levels are mysticism. I'm sorry, a lot of people don't mean it. Just they have a mistaken vocabulary. These are dimensions.
Yeah.
Height, breadth, length, depth. Not at levels. Dimensions. Dimensions. Ha! Hallelujah. Love, not levels. Dimensions. Dimensions. To know with all those things what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there be filled, and thereby and through that be filled with all the fullness of God. How easy is it to become filled with the fullness of God? Know the love of Christ. And then he brings us all the way to chapter 4, and he tells us that we can come into the fullness of the measure, the maturity of the ministry of Jesus unto a fully matured man. And we can either have that, or we can continually for the rest of our life be like little children, constantly tossed about and tricked.
That's right.
And I'm going to go with plan A.
Yes.
I'm going with plan A.
Yes.
I don't be tossed about and tricked.
No.
I don't be constantly deceived, go from one problem to another. You know, rainbow Christianity. Always chasing the rainbow for the pot of gold. And you can never catch up to it. In the sweet Bible, we never can catch up to it. He used to have it now. Today is the day of salvation. I have it now.
Amen.
He's come. He's come. He's here. My Redeemer lives.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. I know he lives. He dwells in me. I mean, Job could say, I know my Redeemer lives and should stand upon the earth in the last day. I can say, I know my Redeemer lives and he's standing inside of me.
Amen.
I mean, come on. Take a step up. Take a step up. He was able to say, no one shall take my uprightness from me. No one shall take my integrity of my life. So long as I have breath in my being, no one. And you know, listen, he had God validating him. God already said he was the perfect man and righteous in all of his ways. Right?
Yes.
And now he's saying, he's coming in and he's saying, no one will take my righteousness from me. No one will take my perfectness from me. Tamim is the word that he used. It's a word that means it has no blemish. It is absolutely perfect. You figure it out. You do your own whatever it is, your brain search. If you want, I'm going to go with the word of God and say God is true. I'll be like a little child. So that's what Father said.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. You would think they know so much in their natural thinking that is based upon their experiences. Huh? It's true. Everything, all your reaction is based upon your experiences. And I was standing in line at an airport the other day. And this little old man came up and he's like, I can't find my wife. She's missing. I said, oh my. I said, you want to find her quickly. And the guy standing beside me goes, well, maybe you don't. My experience was, you want to find your wife quickly. His experience was, man, be happy she's gone. All of our reactions, the way we think, our impulses can be based solely upon all the things that we have experienced. We're not supposed to live out some earthly experience. We've had a divine encounter with the Almighty God to live in the glory of His presence and of His power, to learn how to think like Father thinks. That's His Word. The Word has come. We've been begotten of the Word of God. We're trained every day in the Word of God by the Holy Ghost, who is the Spirit of truth, who speaks truth, the Word of God. But you and I are going to have to open up the Bible and start reading.
Amen.
We've discovered that it is a minority, vast minority, God's people who give themselves every day to the Word. Giving yourself every day to the Word for 10 minutes, you're through the Bible easily in 1 year. And your whole life is beginning to be changed, because every time you start reading the Bible, the Holy Ghost reaches up and slaps you across the head and says, quit acting like that.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Otherwise, you're just making it up as you go, shooting from the hip, just thinking it through, listening to some preacher preaching on the radio or on worse than that on the TV. Huh? I haven't found the grace yet to listen to them. I'm just going to go sit down with the Word of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. I read broadly. It's very difficult. Very, very difficult. I usually start falling off to sleep having to work through all of the commentaries, all the various different things that everybody else thought God said, declaring things that God himself doesn't even know. But then if I start falling asleep, I just open up the Word again. Boom. I'm revived. Hallelujah. He enlightens me with his Word. Hallelujah. He opens up my eyes to behold wondrous things out of his Word. The Lord looks at us now after beginning to set the stage there with so many wonderful things and the lofty expressions of the Spirit that Paul gave when he wrote the crown jewel of his epistles, the epistle to the Ephesians. What a radical church. He says to you and me, now think different. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Huh? Yes. He says, put on now. Be endued. Be clothed. I've been clothed. I've got something that was way better looking than what Jacob made for Joseph. I'm clothed with Christ Jesus, to be endued with Christ, to make no provision for anything that belongs to any natural instincts, to anything that belongs to the realms of self or any of its desires. I know that we want to make doctrines out of a dualism, that we want to translate it, the lust of the flesh, as though it was a demonic entity right now, that we must rid ourselves and divest ourselves of the roots of iniquity, that we may step into the glorious revelation of Christ Jesus the Son. Nonsense. He's the one who's come and delivered us. He's the one. Are you talking about uprooting the roots of iniquity and divesting you of an old man? I'm telling you right now, Christ Jesus did it for us. He did it for us. He put it to death through the redemption that has been purchased for us with his own blood. I can't get more saved than he saved me. I can't get more righteous than he made me. I can't be more holy than what he gave me, this holiness of his. I can't be more new than the new that he made when he made me new. Amen. Come on. Yeah. He's Savior, you're not. I'm not. We accept it. You may look at all these evidence and your friends may come along and tell you that you're not saved. And if you were really saved, you wouldn't be doing this. You wouldn't be doing that. And if you were a son of God, you'd turn the stone into bread and all the rest of this stuff that people come at with. It doesn't even matter. Talk to the hand. I'm not listening. I'm paying no attention. All right. I'm paying no attention. I am said I am. So I am. Huh? I'm only paying attention to what he said, the testimony that God gave of his son to me. Yeah. He's a deliverer. He delivered me. Savior. And he made me new in righteousness and true holiness. I put on the new man. I put on literally the new. It's really man is just an add-on word because it's an assumed word, an expression to make the thought more complete by the translators. Just now put on the new. Huh? If any man be in Christ Jesus, same one who wrote it. In case you didn't know, same person that wrote Ephesians also wrote 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. So he said, put on the new, which is after the image of God created in righteousness and true holiness. And he's saying the same thing when he said, if you be in Christ, you're a new creation. You're a new creation. Old things are passing away slowly, slowly, slowly passing away, slowly. Inch by inch, as you fast and pray, a new inch. All things have passed away. They passed away.
They did. Grandma passed away. You might want to see Grandma, but she passed away and she's not coming back.
She passed away. Old has passed away. The old was crucified with Christ. The old man was crucified. The old was destroyed. We received the circumcision of Christ and put away the body of the sins of the flesh with the circumcision of Christ. Amen. Paul said, Amen. Colossians 2:11. Why? Do we want to say, why do we want to quote scriptures that don't even exist? Why do we want to quote Emerson and mistake it for the Holy Ghost? True. God helps them who help themselves. He works in mysterious ways as wonders to perform. I was in a meeting one time and a preacher was there and he said, and it was a pretty big meeting, And he said, how many of you know God said he works in wondrous ways? Huh? His miracles to perform. And everybody except for a couple people raised their hand. Amen. People living out something that's not even in the Bible. His wonder, working mysterious ways, his wonders perform. He wants to work through you and me, but you got to start thinking different. And then he tells us, you know, how to deal with all the things that are right now are up against us, that are warring against us. And he says to us, he says, understand how to redeem the times. You're going to have the power to subdue nations, to change the course of time. How to redeem the day, the time, for the day is evil. I'm a time redeemer. How to redeem the time, for the day is evil. Don't be drunk with wine wherein is debauchery. People need to get wisdom by coming to California and Southern California and reading the highway signs. If you are driving buzzed, you are driving drunk. Amen. Most Christians don't know that. Oh, I don't drink to get drunk. What do you drink for? Be honest. Don't give me no taste explanation. Buzzed. B-U-Z-Z. Buzzed. Why do you need to get buzzed? See, that you don't want to come true clean and say drunk. Why do you need to get buzzed? Because you got a void and an emptiness inside that God wants to come and fill.
Come on.
He wants to come and touch you. Yeah. Anybody who's watched anybody mess around with alcohol knows that there is no blessing in it. It destroys people's lives. And yet we don't have enough sense in God's community to figure that out. Much less to move in signs and wonders and miracles and to lay hold of that for which we have been arrested by. To lay hold of those things which God arrested us for. These works and greater works. To walk around living out this wonderful life that goes beyond anything that you read about in history. All of that is supposed to whet your appetite. When you read that Joshua commanded the sun and the moon to stand still, huh? That's supposed to whet your appetite. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. To start moving in the spiritual.
Yes.
Got to think different.
Yes.
And then the Lord brings it all the way into this conclusion. He says, finally, brethren, in conclusion, therefore, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Take unto yourself the whole divine ability of God, the whole armament of God, both protective and offensive.
Amen.
Because you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness. And this is a very important point. People forget the dynamic of the reality that we are up against spiritual wickedness. You know, Jesus said in Mark chapter 7, he said, from the heart comes evil thoughts and adulteries and murders. He's talking about the unredeemed man. Understand, he's talking about the unredeemed man. Now, what happens to the redeemed man when he's having to deal with similar kind of thoughts, strife thoughts, hate thoughts, immoral thoughts? What's going on? You are dealing with spiritual wickedness. And then it's not only there, but just holding yourself into a natural confinement of circumstances. Oh no, I better go get my flu shot because I'm the first one to always get it. Anybody starts sniffling and I get the flu. I met a guy the other day and he said, oh, I don't want to shake your hand. He said, I just got a cold. I said, listen, come on, man. You know, come on over here. Listen, I'll hug people with tuberculosis, you know, coughing up blood. Okay, come over here. Yeah, I'm not concerned about it. Really, honestly, I'm not concerned about it. I live in divine health. Why? What happened? What moment of faith took place in my life to where I stepped into divine health and quit getting sick? What happened? What moment happened in my life? And you know, you've heard me talk about that in the School of the Spirit. And I'm telling you right now, it's a prevailing prayer. It's a persistent prayer. It's learning how to boldly pray as God described to us in Luke chapter 11, where the man comes with impudence. The word you can translate impudence, huh? Impudence, shameless boldness. And the scripture Jesus said, telling us about prayer, he said, the man inside will not arise and get him food because he's a friend, but he knows he's not going to go away. Yeah. He's not going to take no for an answer. Remember the woman, the Syrophoenician woman? Yeah. How did she step into great faith? How did she instantly get in great faith? She'd never been around the teaching of Jesus or the ministry of Jesus, but suddenly she's around him for 2 minutes and she's got something that those guys have been hanging out with him for 2 years didn't have. Yes. What happened? She recognized who he was. Amen. More than they did. They were still wondering, what manner of man is this? They were still wondering and amazed, and he's going, yet you hearts, you have hardened. Because you're all amazed that I'm walking on the water right now. You're all amazed that I got in the boat and we're immediately to the other side of shore.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be amazed. That's what he said. That's what he was saying. He said, you just was in the meeting yesterday. I took you into the dimensions, the unlimited dimensions of the way that things really work. You don't have fish because you went out and caught them and cleaned them and worked so hard. You don't have bread because you went out and you ground the wheat into flour and cooked up bread. You have fish and you have bread because I command it to be so. And whatever you speak, it will happen if you'll begin to live in the realms of believing for the impossible, walking in the realms of the Spirit and the miraculous. Okay. So, let me take you a very familiar verse of Scripture that really is, it's this verse of Scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, just turn with me there, and right around verse 14, and I may back up a little bit before that. I want to help you understand something. I want you to understand something. This chapter of the Bible is about teaching you and me how to walk in the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power. Understand this. This is about teaching you and I how to walk in the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power, so that men's faith will be in God and not in us. Not with excellency of speech, not because you're a good orator, not because you're a good teacher. You can take concepts and you can weave them together and it's logical and makes sense. You'll be like Nicodemus, you don't know what you're talking about. Hallelujah. Oh, you may have all the verses of Scripture, but you still don't know what you're talking about. Huh? So, I want you to grab a hold of the reality that this is why we were born of the Spirit. We were born of the Spirit to be Spirit. Those of you who don't know that, before I go into this verse of Scripture, I don't want to leave anybody behind. Let me just show you that real quickly. You can turn to John chapter 3 real quickly, and I will show you this. This is what Jesus described the new birth to be. And anybody who's called upon the name of Jesus has been born of the Spirit and born of the water. You've been born again. To be born of the Spirit and born of the water are synonyms. He constantly used those interchangeably. It's used interchangeably throughout the Bible and even all the way to the very end where the Spirit and the bride says, come and drink. Water is always there in view of salvation. But I want you to, I'm not going to go into that and explain that to you tonight. I want you to look at verse 6. He says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. I want you to understand that that is the same as saying that which is born of the natural is natural. That which is born of a human being is a human being. Okay? And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. This when Jesus is talking about being born of God, being begotten of God, being begotten of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of the Lord overshadowed Mary, and that holy thing that was conceived in her was called the Son of God. The power of God came upon even Saul and David of old, and they received a new heart. But now this is even at another level. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon us and creates a brand new being. It's a spiritual being. It is renewed in His image, in His likeness, after righteousness and true holiness, as I referred to in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24. And I want you to get this in your spirit, and I want you to start prophesying it to yourself and declaring it to yourself and thanking God for all that He's done, because then it's it's going to be something that you're going to begin to live out. You'll be able to transfer that to others also. So you begin to live it out. It's not just good enough to be talking about it. You need to live it out. You need to live in the glory of it, the relationship of it, the presence of His goodness that is brought with it. So you got that verse of Scripture? You see that, the contrast? Now quickly turn with me to Romans chapter 8. And I wanted you to, because Romans chapter 8 really is Paul just doing a little bit more explanation on John chapter 3 in many ways. In Romans chapter 8, look with me here in verse 9. He says, but ye are not in the flesh. I'm going to get verse 8. He says, so then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. There's two things that God clearly describes that you cannot please Him, or you cannot walk with Him, you cannot know Him, you cannot interact with Him. Those that are in the flesh, and those who are in doubt and unbelief. For without faith it is impossible to please God. Impossible, don't care how hard you try. Without faith it's impossible to please God. Doesn't matter how good you are, doesn't matter. Without faith it is impossible to please God. Those that come to God must believe that He is, that He exists, that He's here right now. He is and He's here right now. That's exist. He is and He's here right now. Huh? No matter what you're up against, you say, He is and He's here right now. Hallelujah. He's right with me. Understand this. He says then, good news, you are not in the flesh, but you are in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Huh? You're not in the flesh. You're not of the flesh. You were born just complete. That's like everybody else in the human condition. Huh? Just an ordinary human being under the transgression, under the penalty of death that fell upon all mankind because of Adam's sin. But God, in His mercy and His love, has stepped in. And He's brought redemption. He's brought salvation. He brought the wonderful, glorious miracle of the new birth that creates a new creation, which is entirely of the Spirit. It is very different from the natural. And people look in the mirror and they say, no, I still have an earthly body. I still have bad breath. I still need a shower. Otherwise, I smell terrible. I still have to deal with these opposing problems and these thoughts. Therefore, I must still be in the human condition. No, are you going to base what you believe about God on your experiences? Are you going to base what you believe about God on what He said in His Word? Because there's a whole lot more going on than you can see.
Amen.
And when you only got a little piece of the information and you're passing judgment, you're not a good judge.
Amen.
You need to have the whole counsel. You need to understand every witness on the subject before you pass sentence.
Amen.
Huh? Don't make God a liar.
Amen.
Make every man a liar. Put yourself on the first name on the list.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And let God be true. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Just go ahead and begin to live by the Word. Man does not live by bread alone. Huh? Him, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. You've been begotten of the Word. You've been begotten of the Spirit. You've been begotten of the resurrection.
Amen.
Amazing. Amazing, huh?
Hallelujah.
We've been born again of the incorruptible seed.
Hallelujah.
By the Word of God, which lives and abides forever.
Hallelujah.
I have to deal with the natural thinking. When we start on this, and now we're getting in all kinds of various different Greek ideology. As soon as I say that, it sparks for you all kinds of things that you're trying to explain that terminology based on. And I want to help you with something. But just before you turn back to 1 Corinthians, I'll just go ahead and look at verse 6 because it's really good right here in Romans 8. Seeing this is right here staring at me in the face. He says, but to be carnally minded, and I want you to understand, to be naturally minded. Now, I want you to hold on to this word, because I'm going to show you something maybe you don't know. Okay? Hang on. To be naturally minded or carnally minded. Everybody's made a lot of things out of this. There's people, and they should have known better. They should have known better because they presented themselves as experts. They presented themselves as those who knew. And they said, this is soulish. That is as big as a farce is for me to say that the sky is the ground. The word does not mean that. The Greek word does not mean that at all. And people who try to take approaches to linguistics, trying to create some etymological, lineage of words, that was shown to be debunked in the 1800s. It lived for only like 50 years. It's just ridiculous. It's not even true. And it really messes people up because now they're always having to deal with something that Christ Jesus didn't deal with. And if he left you partly unredeemed, how are you going to get the rest of it finished? There is no sanctification in the sepulcher. Somehow, if he's not, if we're not in him and he and us, if we're not perfectly redeemed by what he's done for us, what redemption is there left? Self-redemption? No. Nobody can move forward without redemption. There's always wiggle room for Satan and the accuser and the liar when you believe that some part of you is still left hanging in the balance. God wants you to know that your spirit and that your soul and that your body are blameless.
Amen. Amen.
So that you could be preserved blameless.
Amen.
1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. I want to live by the word. I don't want traditions of men. I don't want philosophies of men. I don't want Christian ideology. I don't want the traditions of men. It will spoil me after the rudiments of the world and not conform me or allow me to be conformed to Christ. I want to be conformed to Christ. His word produces the miracle faith for me to be able to do it. I've just got to agree with the word of God. I just want you to agree with the word of God. I don't want you to agree with me. I want you to agree with the word of God. I want you to just repeat, I'm not in the flesh, but in the spirit. I just want you to repeat. I don't want you to repeat what I'm saying. Anybody can interpret that. And, oh, what are we going to do? Who knows what the interpretation is? Just read it. Get out of the fear. Get out of the panic. Get into the love.
Amen.
Perfect love casts out all fear.
Amen.
He wrote this to babes, not to the wise and to the prudent. If you need a reference for what on earth does Romans 8:9 mean, then refer to John 3:6. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Hello. Come on. Please. Huh? Living in the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Being his temple.
Yeah.
Having your spirit joined unto him. Being his. Stamped, not USDA, but stamped Kingdom of God all the way.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Pure, genuine, divine. Hallelujah. Come on. What's wrong with that? Come on. Come on. This is the true riches. I'm not interested in no diamond ring, no flashy Rolex watches, no crown upon my head, no super shiny shoes. I got the divine. I got the true riches. I'm drinking of the realms of the heavenly. Give me a break. Try to reduce and erode the glory of the heavenly riches to a place that it's monetized. My goodness. Please. Father is, according to his abundant wealth, according to his exceeding riches and glory, look at what he's provided for you and me. I'm not going to monetize that. What? What? You need some money? Go catch a fish. There'll be some money in the fish's mouth. Huh? Hallelujah. Papa owns it all. His bank account's huge.
That's right.
It's huge. It's huge. I quit living in this realm of money and started living in the realm of faith a long time ago. I'm going to tell you right now, faith can generate more currency than you can ever imagine. Just you got to learn how to walk on the water. You got to learn how to recognize, wait a minute, my natural mind says you don't walk on the water. You sink in the water.
Right.
But the realms of the spirit says, no, we walk on the water.
Amen.
He's mastered all the physical realm. And all I have to do is hear his word. All he's got to do is speak his word, and I just got to hear his word, and I can master the physical realm too, and I can come walking on the water, and I can speak to a mountain and say, get out of my way.
Amen.
And has to obey me. I can say to the mulberry tree, be plucked up by the roots and planted in the sea. The first indication of hydroponics. But it's more radical than that. It's being able to change the course of nature. To say to the sun and the moon. Somebody was asking me, should we help people understand what all had to happen in the cosmos for this to take place? No. Look, faith doesn't need to know the mechanism. Huh? Joshua didn't need to know all the things about how the planets and the earth was revolving around the sun, and they got to say to the earth, stop, not the... He's from his vantage points, the sun and the moon, and that's all faith needed to get the job done.
Amen.
We want to sit there and try to think it through. Well, let's think, what is this particular disease? What is it caused by? Oh, my. I mean, it's all the way down to the cellular level. Oh, my. Oh, it's a genetic mutation. Oh, that's even worse. God can't even do that. We make it so difficult. Instead of just saying, you foul spirit, I hate all. You foul spirit of sickness and disease.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord doesn't need the pathology. Jesus. In his faith.
Yes.
Faith is speaking forth of the word.
Amen.
Because you live by the word.
Yes, sir.
You live by it. First you're born by it, born of it. So you can live by it. And living by it is following the one who is the living word who revealed the written word. Christ Jesus is not locked into the realms of private interpretation, and the Bible is open for anyone's interpretation. It is living, it is real, it's genuine, it's proven. The evidence of it is without, it's impeccable. It's without debate. Now, see if I can try to do this quickly. I don't do much quickly, but go back to 1 Corinthians. Say, I'm not in the flesh.
I'm in the Spirit.
I walk in the Spirit. Look, you know, understand, Jesus was manifested in the flesh. God was manifested in the flesh. But he didn't live by the flesh. Paul said, though I'm living in the flesh in the sense of an earthly body, I don't war after the flesh or the earthly body or my human ability. I war after the realms of the divine empowerment that has been given to me. The weapons of my warfare are not natural.
Yes, sir.
Natural. Before I move on, let me just go show you, because I don't want you to be hung up on this word. Let me go show, well, just go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Look at this word here, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, because people get tripped up by this word. So I just want to kind of help you, okay? Just a little bit here, okay? So look with me here in verse 13. He says to us that, first of all, verse 12, he says, we've not received the spirit of the world, eh? The prince and the power of the air, the spirit of this world, but we've received the spirit of God, praise God, that why? Why? So that we might freely know everything that is of God. Remember, Jesus said, everything that belongs to the Father, I'm quoting John chapter 16 now, he said, everything that belongs to the Father is mine. Therefore, I said, he shall take of mine and shall reveal it, disclose it, transmit it to you, as he's leading you and guiding you into all the truth. He's taking everything that belongs to the Father and everything that belongs to Jesus, and he's revealing it to us. He's transmitting it to us. He's unveiling it to us. Are you with me?
Yes.
And you can't have that transmission unless first you're born of the Holy Ghost, born of the Spirit, made a new creation. And so that's what Paul is saying here, right here in verse 12. He says, we don't have the spirit of the world. We have the Spirit of God so that we can know those things that are. He's doing. No. So that we know the things that is freely given us to do. What is he given to me freely? What is mine? And remember the context here. The context is Paul said, we come to you with the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. This is how we preach the gospel. We know nothing but Jesus Christ and him crucified. Number one, that means that dealt with all of the sin, that dealt with all the separation, that dealt with every part of the enmity between us and God. It was completely removed in the cross of Calvary, where he bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that now we being dead to sin might live unto. Might live unto
righteousness.
By whose wound we were healed, cured.
Amen.
By whose wound we were cured.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I mean, if you just walk out of here just believing that, man, I'm dead to sin.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm just dead to it. It comes at me, I'm going to kill it. It comes at me, I'm going to say no to it.
Amen.
You know, there's a realm that God wants to take us into, that he wants to talk to us about, that is plainly revealed in his word, but right now we can't see it and hear it, even though you can read it. Because all revelation is, God retains all rights to revelation. He opened up their eyes that they may understand on the road to Emmaus. Remember that? Luke chapter 24. Huh? He retains all right to revelation. And revelation is something that we always see happening in people's life as a result of obedience. You obey God. He comes to us in His love, and He tugs on our heart, and it causes us to know that we need Him, that we need the change, we need the redemption that only He can bring, and we step out in obedience to the faith, and there the great miracle takes place. And there we begin to see Jesus. He gives us a measure of ability to see and a measure of faith. And then as we walk with God, that revelation begins to become greater and greater. And we understand more and more. And you just walk it out with Him one step at a time. You don't figure it out. You don't wrestle the Scripture to your own destruction. You let the Spirit of the Lord minister to you. So I'm now in a situation where I can freely receive all the things that have been given to me by God. I can see what eyes not seen, hear what ears not heard, understand what's never entered the hearts of men. That's cause to dance around now and rejoice and shout a while. Why? Because it's not a fantasy. It's not fictional. It's not something that is out of reach. It's not a concept that somehow is not meaningful to me. It's something that I must receive. I just must accept it.
Yes.
It's something I receive. As many as received Him, you got to receive Him. You can't just stand there and talk with Him outside the door. He's knocked on the door. You open at the door. Hey, who are you? Oh, I'm God. I love you so much. And I'm giving all these things to you. Really, you have? Oh, that is so wonderful. I'm so appreciative of this so great a salvation that you've given me. And you're still talking outside the door. You need to receive Him. You need to invite Him in and set Him down. You need to receive Him. Outside the door, you've not received Him. You're still having a conversation outside. Why don't you receive Him in? As many as received Him, He gave them the authority to be sons of God. I have the authority to be a son. Yes. As many as would believe upon His name, for His name is above every name.
Yes.
His name is powerful. The
That's
name
right.
of Jesus. Huh? Huh? These signs shall follow them that believe in His name.
Right.
He's doing the work through us. It's His work. He's doing the work. It's not our work. It's His work.
Amen.
Jesus said, it's the Father that does the work. John chapter 14, He said, in these works that I do, these miracles that I do, is just simply proving to you that it's the Father that does the work. So if you don't believe me for the word's sake, believe me for the work's sake. And if any man believes, these works shall he do also. I mean, it's beautiful when you begin to think about the context there, huh? And what Jesus is bringing us into and understanding that He's with us, working with us. He's right here with us. He's not aloof. He's not far away. He's present. He's God at hand. He's near. He's nigh unto you. Huh? You don't have to ascend to bring Him down, descend to bring Him up. But what does the Word of God say? He's near to you. He's nigh unto you. Where? And He breathed into them the breath of life, and they became a living being. A living being. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
A living being. Nefesh, a living being, which people get all tripped up in Hellenistic Greek doctrines of Plato, of Aristotle, of Socrates, and say, oh, soulish, because to them the soulish realm was a realm of the demiurge. And it's ultimately come over and been integrated into Christian traditions. No, nefesh, a living being. His soul, it speaks of the whole of you being. Not some little part of you. It's the whole of your being. It's the whole of your being. Hallelujah. It's the whole of my being. He fills the whole of my being. Huh? He's not shut out. My soul belongs to the devil or me or somebody. I'm not sure who. People, there is another word for another issue that you need to deal with. It's called self. And isn't it a terrible thing that we would have to deal with a notion that we don't even recognize ourselves? That's pretty disconnected. Yeah. You don't recognize yourself. Until you recognize yourself, how are you going to deny yourself? You have to deny yourself.
Amen.
Jesus denied Himself, His holy self, to do only what the Father said. People are messed up with Aristotelism rather than being fixed up with Godisms. They're messed up with all these crazy Hellenistic concepts rather than being put together by the Spirit of the Lord. Just make it simple. You belong to Him.
Yes. Amen.
You bought with a price.
That's right.
Amen.
Therefore, glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are His. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on. Hallelujah.
Seeing as you purified your soul in obeying the truth unto unfeigned love of the brethren. See that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Now wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Listen, these words, it's a soul word. It just speaks of your whole being, your living being. Get out of somehow dichotomizing yourself into some one for you, Lord, one for me, and one for the devil. I guess we got the body, the devil's got the soul, and God's got the spirit. Good Hellenistic doctrine. Good Hellenistic doctrine. If you know the doctrines of Gnosticism, it's a perfect fit. Because pneuma, which is spirit, was all that could be of God. Soul, sarke, soul, couldn't be of God. It was a demonic realm. It was a demonic realm to try to encapsulate pneuma, spirit. And then the body is another even worse demonic realm that encapsulates pneuma. And now you got to deal, if you ever want to ascend to a place of union with God, you got to deal with this corrupt body that's standing in your way with all of its desires that are against the spirit. This is pure Gnosticism, and I'm not speaking Christian. I'm not speaking biblical doctrine, but though it sounds like it. And your soul is the next thing that you got to deal with. Otherwise, if you don't deal with it, you're going to be reincarnated. And Origen, who is church father, anybody know that? Not my father. He believed that you had to be reincarnated until you fully dealt with all of the perversions in the soul. It's not Vedic doctrine, it's Hellenistic doctrine. I know this is a little bit hard to deal with a little bit, but just hang with me because I want to talk about the things that trip up your understanding. Please, just hang with me just a minute. I know it's trying. But none of these things, the Bible speaks 100% opposite to these things. The Lord's called you and I to glorify Him in our body, in our spirit, which are His. And our whole being is His too. Our whole being is His temple. He's come to dwell in fleshly tabernacles of clay. Isn't that beautiful? It's beautiful. It truly is. Now, verse 13 says, which things also we speak not in the words of man's wisdom, but to what the Holy Ghost says and teaches. What? What things? What things are we talking about? All the things which are of God that have been freely given to me. All the things that are freely given to me of God. The Holy Spirit is coming and bringing to me all the things that are freely given to me of God. What is freely given to me of God? Everything that Jesus has.
Amen.
And everything that the Father has is what Jesus has, so He's freely given to you and me everything that the Father has. This is good news. Yeah, yeah. This doesn't sound like bad news to you. This is good news. And you don't have to divest yourself of something before you can ever have this. I'm telling you, listen, He is happy to dwell in flesh. In the flesh. That's why the Gnostics could not receive that God was manifested in the flesh. That Christ came in the flesh. Huh? That Almighty come to dwell in temples of clay in these bodies. Yes. Yes. He inhabits my soul, amen, my whole being. Amen. Would you start seeing yourself different? I want to break this thing off of you so you can see yourself different. I know I'm dealing with sacred cows. I tell you, people say, you're saying we're not in the flesh. Are you saying we've been raised from the dead? No, we've not been raised from the dead. I'm saying that we no longer are in the flesh as Jesus said we're no longer in the flesh. As Paul said, we're no longer in the flesh. We're no longer walking after and living after a natural, earthly, unredeemed existence. The unredeemed versus the redeemed. walking as a mere man rather than walking after the Spirit. And hang on, because I'm going to tell you right now, I'm getting ready to bring out the guns. Just hang on, I'm going to get you the guns out here in just a minute. I'm going to bring the big heavy tee. We're going to nail this thing into the ground once and for all. Churchill said, if you want to make a point, get a pile driver. We got the pile driver out, or the big bangs are getting ready to come. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Which things? This is how I'm living my life. Why? So that I can demonstrate the Holy Ghost in power.
Amen.
So that I can move in signs and wonders and miracles. Paul said, we have fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost. Huh? Romans 15:19. That's how we're supposed to minister.
Amen.
We just want to do it with speeching, talking. Well, what do you think about the weather? That's our icebreaker. Did you know the Chargers moved out of San Diego? Did anybody tell you that Jesus loves you? They're not going to do anything for anybody. It's not going to do anything for anybody. You're going to slip Jesus loves you in the midst of the Chargers and the weather. It ain't going to do anything for anybody. The Lord wants us to not come as scribes and Pharisees. He wants us to come with divine power and authority.
Amen.
And reach into people's lives and unlock their heart with the word of knowledge.
Amen.
Just like Jesus did with Nathaniel.
Come on.
Hallelujah. But Jesus didn't give Nathaniel the word of knowledge and tell him that what he was doing under the fig tree, basically. Huh? He would have remained in unbelief as he was before he encountered him. Everything that belongs to Jesus has been transferred to you and me tonight, right here in this place.
Right.
All you got to do is reach out and receive him and then begin to function it in the authority of his name.
Amen.
Just reach out and receive it. Just reach out and receive it. Receive it now. Take it in. Take it in. It's mine. It's mine. And you're going to have to deal with a lot of thoughts that come from experience. I've seen that the spirit of offense holds more people in prison than any other activity of the demonic offense. Shuts down the moving of the Holy Ghost, imprisons a person. You're going to have to learn how. You have to learn how to forgive and walk, which is really a function or an outworking of love, just walking in love. You're going to walk in mercy. You're going to walk in forgiveness. You're just going to be forgiven. You're not going to be offended by anything. Perfect peace have they who love the Word. Hey? Perfect peace have they. I love the Word. Christ Jesus, the living Word. Perfect peace have they who love the Word, and nothing offends them. Can't offend me. Hallelujah. And it's not because I'm dead. It's because I'm alive.
Amen.
Here you give an argument. Oh, you can't offend a dead man. I can't. I'm a dead man. Come on. I can't. What are you talking about? Of course you can. But I'm not dead. I'm alive. I once was dead. I'm now alive.
Amen.
I'm not a living dead. I'm a living life. I'm living life. I'm living his life. I was dead in my trespasses and sins, so that I was crucified with Christ and buried with him by baptism into his death, so that I might be raised up together with him, so that I might be alive. Hallelujah. You can't offend a living person in Christ Jesus. You can't wrap your head around being dead, trying to be dead. I'm dying. I'm dead. The Lord didn't say to die to yourself. He used another word, a little harder.
Yeah.
Deny.
Yeah.
Every day. Can't we get this done? Oh, yes. Yes, we can get this done. Day by day. Huh? And it's not that difficult and it's not that hard. It's just saying, look, Father, I just want to do your will. I've got a bunch of ideas. I've got a bunch of wishes and desires. Fine, I want yours, because I know yours is better. I know I've convinced myself that mine are better, huh? But I know that yours are better. I know they are, kinda. I can only imagine that they really are, kinda. The Lord wants to open your eyes and cause you to see those things which he's purposed for you and me, huh?
Yes, sir.
To begin again to see and hear and know what he's planned for those who love him, which he's now revealing to us by the Holy Spirit. So verse 14, he says, look at this, but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit. That's the same word for carnal, same word we just used over there for carnal.
Yes.
Sarkikos. You could say suchikos, but it's a little easier to pronounce it sarkikos. And no, it has no etymology with suke. No. That's debunked. It is a unique word for natural, not for soul or soulish. It's natural. Which you can take some liberty with and say carnal, but that's really a Latin derivation of psychikos. Huh? Are you with me? And I'm not going to try to give you a bunch of Greek. I'm just trying to help you understand. Wait a minute. This means natural. You could translate it carnal. No. I want you to hold your finger on this, because before I read this verse of Scripture, I want to show you what natural is. Okay, you ready?
Yep.
Go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I want to blow up Hellenism right now. Here we go. Get ready. I'm going to blow it up. It's getting ready to disappear. It's getting ready to go boom. It's going to dissipate. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready?
Yes.
In verse 46, howbeit that was first which is spiritual. Howbeit that was not first which was spiritual, but that which is natural. Okay? We're talking about Adam. When God created Adam in his image and his likeness, and he gave him just a natural terrestrial body. Natural body. Natural. Not an eternal, not a spiritual body. Natural. See this? No. Okay? Same word. Same word as carnal. Same word as natural. Back there in Romans chapter 8. Huh? Same word as in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Natural. Are you with me?
Yes.
Look here. So he says, the first man is of the earth, earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earthy, such as also they that are earthy. And as the heavenly, they which are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. And everywhere you just see this word earthly, he's using the word natural. So you have a natural body. It's just natural. It's earthly. It's that which we're born with. It's that which we come into this world with. It's that which is corruptible. That which is going to pass away. It's not unrighteous. It's not unholy. It's his purchased possession. He's redeemed us with his blood to glorify him in our body and our spirit. We've been empowered to do that. So go back over here. Now that you know that natural is not something necessarily evil, there is no question about it that Paul is comparing the difference between the unredeemed state, the unregenerated state, and the redeemed state. But if I can't get you any other way, what's happened is people have been espousing doctrines that try to take the unredeemed condition and put it in this redeemed state. Here, there's no question about it that first and foremost, when he says natural, he's talking about the unredeemed, unregenerated person. Just as when Jesus is saying in John chapter 3 and verse 6, he's talking about the flesh, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. He's talking about the unredeemed, the unregenerated person, Nicodemus, and everybody else. And when he says spirit or spiritual, he's talking about the regenerated. He's talking about the redeemed person. He says to us, but the natural man, the unregenerated, the unredeemed, but not only the unregenerated and unredeemed, but the person who thinks naturally. Because I want to show you, just hang on this verse of Scripture and just look at chapter 3, verse 1. Just look at chapter 3, verse 1. I want to sandwich this thing in and squeeze it down for you. In chapter 3, verse 1, he says, but brethren, I could not come to you and speak to you as spiritual, but as natural. You with me? Natural, natural, natural. They that to be carnally minded or to be naturally minded is death.
Yes.
It's not life and peace. It's not going to produce faith. It's not going to produce that outworking of the Holy Ghost in your life. It's going to produce doubt and unbelief. It's going to try to limit all that God can do based upon your experiences in this life and a physical framework of how you think things have got to function. So Paul says, and I want to grab a hold of you in this concept of moving in the spiritual and understanding that the spiritual is absolutely equated to being born of the Spirit and living by the Spirit and walking in the Spirit. And it's the realm where nothing is impossible for them that believe. It is a place where you and I get to now receive continually downloads from heaven, where he takes and transmits all that belongs to the Father, because we're willing to cooperate with them and we're willing to move with them in this Holy Ghost realm, in the spiritual realm.
Amen.
So, hang with me. Hang with me. So Paul says, I couldn't talk to you in the terms of spiritual. I couldn't talk to you in terms of the heavenly. I couldn't talk to you in terms of what God's doing. I couldn't talk to you in terms of what Jesus is doing. I couldn't talk to you in terms of the reality of faith and the moving of the power of God. I had to talk to you on the basis of a human level of how you function in your human life and how you're constrained and confined by your human condition. That's what he says.
Yes.
He doesn't say you're unregenerated. He's not talking about an unregenerated state, and that's why it's so important to recognize, wait a minute, hold up. These words are not necessarily locked down to a contrast between the unregenerated and the regenerated, the redeemed and the unredeemed. Because, once again, we talk about a natural body versus a spiritual body. It's sown a corruptible body, it's raised a incorruptible body. It's sown a natural body, it's raised a spiritual body. He says, I have fed you with milk. No, forgive me. Brethren, I cannot speak to you as spiritual, but as unto natural, even as unto babes in Christ. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. Hey, it's better to be a babe than to be nothing.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
Can you hear me? Hello.
Yeah.
Wave at me if you can hear me. It's better to be a babe than nothing. But for the Father, the Lord wants us to come to a fully matured man. He wants to start thinking different. He wants to start agreeing with him. He wants us to start moving with him. He wants to start doing his work, doing what it is he's done, doing.
Right.
He's redeemed the people who's zealous, huh? Who's zealous.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jealous,
amen.
Huh? Huh? Who's full of a warrior-like spirit,
amen.
Huh? Who's passionate about good works.
Amen.
We understand how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good works, who went about doing good, healing all
amen.
Who were oppressed of the devil. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's the works. That's the good works.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Paul didn't say, I fully preached the gospel, fed all the orphans, and took care of all the old people. He said, I have fully preached the gospel. Not to say that we're not supposed to take care of the orphans and the widows and their affliction, huh? And the old folks. We're supposed to. But that isn't the good works he's talking about over here. He's talking about, I fully preached the gospel with signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
So how are you going to begin to move with God? How are you going to learn to be yielded to God? How are you going to think that you're able now to step into this realm of the moving of the Spirit of God, to move in faith and signs and wonders and miracles? There is so much of a dynamic that comes down on a personal level where we're running flat out doing what we want to do. Because we think it's important. And it's got to get done now. And we prioritize what we think is good. And we put God on hold. That's got to change.
Yes.
That's hard, ain't it? That's hard, isn't it? You can go ahead and say yes.
Yes.
It's hard, isn't it? It really is. Dealing with the priorities of your own self-interest is a hard issue. To say, wait a minute, Father, I want to deal with your priorities. Lord, I want to seek first the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
What are you telling us? Aren't we supposed to, you know, go to work and take care and provide? And, you know, everybody understands how to quote what Paul said in his exhortation, he that does not provide for his own is worse than infidel and has denied the faith. They also know how to quote, be fervent in business. But they do not know how to quote Matthew chapter 6, take no thought for what you shall wear or what you shall eat.
That's right.
They know how to quote that one. And they don't understand what's going on and what's being said and the seeming contradiction that exists between them. And there is no contradiction at all. How you prioritize things, how you seek first the kingdom of God, how you don't go after trying to provide for yourself, but you let the Lord be your provider. How you learn how to walk in divine provision so that you can begin to walk into a whole other dimension of God's stewardship over the things that belong to Him.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to get off on another subject here. I'm still trying to drive this home. But the natural man, verse 14, does not receive the things of the Spirit. So many people do not flow in the operation of the Holy Ghost because self-consciousness has got them locked down. The mechanism of what they think it's got to look like, Some people are just really super polite. And once again, it's the self-consciousness. They're locked down in the realm. They don't want to be rude or interrupting. They don't want to be rude or interrupting. That means you're serving men while you don't want to be rude and interrupting. Rather than recognizing that Father's church is filled with the expressions of prophecy and praise and tongues and interpretation in tongues while you serve in the interest of men and not serving God. The natural mind or the natural thinking of men is based upon what he can perceive out of a natural, you know, events that has happened in his life, the predictable events. God, the Holy Ghost, is totally unpredictable.
Yes.
He's totally unpredictable. He's like the wind. You don't know where it's coming from. You don't know where it's going. It's totally unpredictable. Can change at any moment. Father wants you to earnestly, he wants you to be desperate and passionate about the spiritual. Yes. Somebody says, I'm not very spiritual. Well, you want to be very spiritual?
Yes.
You want to change that real quickly.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Because as soon as you said you're not very spiritual, you just said, I'm not very saved. I'm not very of the Holy Ghost. I'm not very of the Spirit. Because the contrast is the spiritual and the natural. This is the contrast. And if I had more time here tonight, I'd start parsing out for you the various uses of flesh. So you can begin to understand, wait, what is the Lord talking about being manifested in the flesh, you know, having suffered in the flesh, versus we're not in the flesh. And the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these. But we don't have time to do that. And all of them use the same word. Same Greek word. Same sarx word. What you need to understand, more than trying to linguistically grab a hold of things, is you want to understand the big picture. When you were born again, you came into the realms of the Spirit. And that realm of the flesh, that realm of the natural existence, that earthly human existence, which is related to the unredeemed state, ceased to exist. Can you just accept that?
Yes.
Is there anybody in here having a problem accepting that? Because what that does is it opens you wide open now in a yielded state to receive all that the Holy Ghost wants to give you. And there's no wiggle room for the devil to condemn you and to browbeat you and say that you're not worthy. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Listen. If we understand just simply this, there is therefore no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the human ability.
Yeah.
Human ability. Human ability. Okay? Not the demonic realm. Huh? Now the works of the demonic realm are manifested, which are these. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Huh? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Not the works of the human ability. Huh? For Ishmael was a son after the flesh, after the human ability, not after the demonic realm. He wasn't a child of the devil. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Isaac was of the Spirit. He was that which God only could do. The supernatural went beyond the human ability. Huh? The natural is the human ability. The spiritual is the divine ability. It's a supernatural ability. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Do you understand?
Yes.
Read it again. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's real simple. You can walk after yourself and be completely out of the will of God because God has commanded you. Jesus said, he said this to us. He said, if you want to be my disciple, then you must deny yourself daily.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you do that? Do you know what that looks like? Do you know why you need to do that? Is that different from the flesh? Is it different from the natural? Do you understand? No. Hang in there. You will. You will. Literally living by the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, functioning at the Spirit, is giving yourself over to imitating Jesus, to being conformed to His image, recognizing that with God's Spirit, not His own Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all, He freely gives us all things by Him. He's freely giving to us everything that belongs to heaven, everything that belongs to joy. Hallelujah. Everything that belongs to His happiness, His goodness, everything that belongs to divine protection, divine health, divine provision. He's given to us everything that belongs to, did I say perfection, divine perfection? Because I want to say it again. Can you hear me?
Yes.
And the natural realm says all of those guys got sick, and I'm usually the first one to catch the flu, and so therefore I need to get my flu shot. Because it's predictable. Are you with me?
Yes.
The spiritual says, sickness can't touch me.
Amen.
Spiritual says, I have all authority over sickness and disease.
That's right.
I have authority to cast out devils, speak with new tongues, lay hands on the sick, they recover. The natural says, if you take up a snake is going to bite you, you're going to get bit, you're going to die. Huh? The spiritual says, because the word of God is purely spiritual, the word of God says, you're immune to the poison of the viper and to the poison of the deadly things, which were really, once again, those were the assassin's tools. Those are the threats to kill you, to destroy you. It's not something you go and dilly-dally around with and mess with. Many people want an excuse for their pathetic state. They want to salve their unbelief. There's no excuse for your pathetic state, and there's no salve for it either.
Amen.
And you shouldn't want to stay there. God delivered you.
Amen.
And you should want to be delivered. That's the spiritual realm, that's living in the heavenly. That's being seated together with Christ in the heavenly place. Somebody says it's positional. No, it's experiential. It's ethical, it's relational. It's imparted, it's imputed. It's positional, it's experiential. Read the Bible. The Lord leaves no excuse. Jesus was absolutely at a very disgusted and irritated state with all unbelief and all willingness to reduce things to a natural limitation. They were exceedingly amazed because he was walking on the water. He got in the boat. They were immediately to the other side of the shore. And he said, have you hearts? Oh, you slow to believe. Oh, you faithless people. Oh, you hardened heart folks. I don't want them saying that of me.
No.
I'm saying, let's do this thing.
Yes.
Let's go take Kashmir this year.
Yes.
This is, no, you can't take Kashmir. I'm in the spiritual realm.
Amen.
I'm in a faith realm. Amen. There's no difference between these things. Huh? I'm in a joy realm. Does that mean this sadness isn't going to come out against me? Sure it is. I'm going to bust it in the head.
Yeah.
I'm going to take his head off. I'm going to cut it. I got the sword of the spirit. That's not for buttering bread.
That's right.
It's for taking it. I'm going to cut his head off. Huh? Sorrow and sadness, you flee away. You get scared. That means it's scared. It's scared. When you flee away, you're scared. Huh? Sorrow and sadness, scared to death of joy. Praise and thanksgiving. Rejoicing and celebration. Huh? This is where I'm going to live. Ultimately, once again, here, the Word of God is born in us. The Spirit of God is a wellspring springing out of us. Does that mean that we're not going to have to deal with lying, assailing thoughts, things that would tempt us? Augustine said, temptation is proof that you still have the sin nature. He really forgot a couple of very important points there in that conclusion, didn't he? First of all, he forgot how that Adam was tempted and he had no sin nature. Oops. Augustine, oops. Put the thinking cap on. And he also forgot that Jesus was tempted in all ways that we are and without sin. So temptation is no indication of the sin nature. Some vile, evil root of iniquity still dwelling in me. I just had a bad thought. You can't be tempted without a thought of something wrong. Something that is bad. What are you going to do with it? It's the issue is, are you going to cast it down? Are you going to throw it down? Are you going to limit yourself to it? That's the interaction or the interface with the demonic. That's not even the interface with the natural. And then I can take and parse this out some more. Paul made a very different definition of what is worldly versus what is earthly. And the segregation of the worldly was absolutely essential. Or the secular. Nobody wants to hear that today. Because we've well advanced to the apostate situation. The apostasy is well underway. The apostasy, I said, is well underway. Mariah Woodworth, Eder, Wigglesworth, F.F. Bosworth. Those people just 100 years ago, they would have looked at you and I, they would have looked at the situation in the church right now and said, Ichabod, the glory has departed. It's fully worldly. It's proven by its fruits. True. It's true. Just go read their doctrines. Go read what they said. And go look at what you're doing with your life. And then find out whether or not you can justify your state. Because people, you know, this is why I love people to fast. I love people to go into fast and praying, especially the first of the year, because you allow things to be established in your life through compromises and won't even recognize it. You fast, and fast means that you shut off everything secular. You don't listen to the radio. You don't watch television. You don't involve yourself with anything but prayer and the Word of God. Huh? Just the things feasted on that which belongs to heaven. That's it. Suddenly, you know, after about 21 days, you're going, wait a minute, this is very different. Now you try to step back into that realm of all of the things that are normal and everyday, normal, natural. What everybody else is doing can actually cross the boundary of natural into worldly. Uh-oh. Come out from among them, touch not the unclean things, says the Lord, and I shall receive you. And I should be your God, and you should be my sons and daughters. True.
Yes.
And so, that's the resounding. After he says, after he tells us, you righteous, not unrighteous, you light, not darkness, right? Yes. You the temple of God, not belonging to idols, right?
Yes.
Remember that? 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Mm-hmm. Then he says, come out from among them, touch not the unclean thing. He's saying, separate yourself from that. He says, dearly beloved, I beseech you, cleanse yourself completely. Completely isolate yourself, cleanse yourself from the filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit. Ooh, try to put that in your little doctrinal concepts that are all neatly put together for yourself. Cleanse yourself from the filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Does that mean that I still have some uncleanness in my spirit after redemption? No. It means that I will stand against all the fleshly lusts that war against my soul from the demonic realm, and I will not allow myself to be integrated with those things that belong to lasciviousness, those things that are the works of the demonic, the works of the flesh realm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hmm? The god of this world, the prince of the power of the air. The works of the flesh realm, because you can't say Jesus was manifested in the flesh and that is somehow the flesh that's demonic. He wasn't manifested in a demonic realm. The works of the flesh, the works of the unredeemed, unregenerated man living under the prince and the power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit of disobedience, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, that realm, which we once had our conversation in times past. Huh? But now we're made alive in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah? The contrast. Are you with me?
Yes.
A clear separation. This is what I'm driving home for you tonight. Something that's important. A clear separation between the unredeemed state and the redeemed state. Belonging to God and belonging to the devil. And then I want to take it to another level and just simply say to you, it's the difference of walking after the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ, versus walking after the natural realm, the natural thinking, the realm that in which men decide things and conclude things and predict things. So let me, a little bit more here. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. So Paul's over here saying to the church at Corinthians, church at Corinth, he's saying, you guys are walking naturally, so everything around is the Spirit. When I tell you, you can multiply the loaves and the fishes. When I tell you, you can work miracles where you can walk in dreams and visions, it's all foolishness to you. Really, you can substitute it because you just have to say, why would the King James translate the same word natural here and carnal here? Or why would other translations mix up words? Some are faithful to translating words consistently. Some translations are. King James wasn't. It's because people integrating their doctrinal ideas into translation of Scripture. So he's not just talking about unredeemed state. Understand, he's not talking about a redeemed state. He's talking about you and I still remembering our former conversation, still thinking like mere men, still thinking like somehow we're not moving in all that God has provided for us when he empowered us with the Holy Ghost. So, moving on. The natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness in him, neither can he know them, because they spiritually discerned. So here he says, but he that is spiritual discerns everything. The same word here. See that? Discerned? Yeah. Now he changed it to judge. Discern. He is spiritual. He that is spiritual discerns all things. It's kind of like John said, you have an unction from the Holy One and know all things. Singular. Different. He that is spiritual, discerns all things. In other words, the Holy Spirit has given to us a divine ability to realize what's of God, what belongs to God, and all these things that belong to God that he's been given to us so that we're not going to be limited by the predictable human consequences. Oh, everybody's got a flu, I'm going to get the flu too. So I can now walk in a realm above all of this stuff. Sickness and disease.
Amen.
To have all authority, all power and authority over all sicknesses and all diseases.
Amen.
People have a bad experience and say, well, I prayed and I got worse. You shouldn't have quit.
Amen.
As you're going through the fiery trials.
Amen.
The faith.
Amen.
You shouldn't have quit.
Amen.
You shouldn't allow some situation to change your opinion of who God is and what his word declared.
Amen.
Because if you'll stand fast, if you will not faint, if you'll stand up, huh? If you'll not man up, but spirit up.
Amen.
Huh? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I mean, the enemy used to try to intimidate me in this room too. I mean, I have people I've walked up to, people who had chronic diseases. When I first started ministering, said, oh, you don't have to have that anymore. And immediately they were healed. Then I pray for people and they get worse. You know, I'd have just a whole, array of different results. Just great miracles take place on one hand without hardly any effort. Seems like on the other hand, people get worse. The enemy's trying to intimidate us. I'm not going to change my opinion of what God said. I'm going to let my opinion be God's opinion. Actually, the word we translate heresy literally means opinion. I'm not going to let my opinion deviate from what God's opinion is that is expressed in his word. I'm going to agree with him. I'm going to declare his word. I'm going to live in this realm. I'm going to say, Christ is in me. That's purely spiritual. It's purely of the spirit. The natural thinking would say, I'm not sure. The spiritual says, I will behold myself in the mirror and see the image, and there seeing the image of God, I will be changed from glory to glory. The natural thing would say, that is impossible. I went and looked in my mirror, and all I saw was more wrinkles. And so I can never embrace 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, and allow it to be mine. Where I know that I am a living epistle,
yes,
written by God. The natural thinking doesn't understand. The natural thinking cannot understand that I am the temple of God, the Holy Ghost, even when I fail.
Yeah.
And even when I'm stumbling along, I'm still the temple of the Holy Ghost, that God the Father dwells here. The natural thinking can't even... The natural thinking is better with walking on the water than that you are now the dwelling place of Almighty God. Think about it. The reasonings, the logizimos of 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. The logics. Huh? The weapons of our warfare are not natural. Because we're going to go carnal and we're all going to get over into the sin nature again. Natural. The weapons of warfare are not guns and bows and arrows. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Nothing about demonic in there. Nada. You hear me?
Yes.
The weapons of our warfare are not natural or, may I say it, carnal. But they are God power.
Yes.
That's what the Greek language literally says, God power. But King James, others translate it, mighty through God. Weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. Literally, it's God power. Istios dunamis. God power. I got God power.
Yeah.
I have the strength of the Lord, the power of my power is mine. I got God power.
Amen.
That's entirely spiritual, man. Your natural thinking can't wrap its thought around that for 1 second. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about an unregenerated state. I'm talking about thinking like a person in an unregenerated state. Thinking like a person who's bound by the physical and natural laws. A separation from God, no longer, not in union with God, but trying to be in union with God, living out a purely human existence under the human condition. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Are you getting this?
Yes. Yes.
Kinda?
Yes.
Lord, we need the spirit of wisdom, revelation, and the knowledge of you, so that the eyes of our understanding can be opened, so we can have some, this spiritual understanding, the mind of the Spirit, the thinking of the Spirit, the mind of Christ. So we can see what your inheritance is in us and the exceeding greatness of your power that you've given to us. That's entirely spiritual. Now I'm not limited to the natural outcome. Now if it comes at me, I'll throw it off. I'll overcome it. For greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I'll throw it off. I have authority over it to trample over scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy so that nothing can by any means hurt me or harm me. That's purely spiritual. That's truly being of the Spirit and not subject to natural consequences. The same things that go on in everybody else's life. The same thing that happens because Satan is the prince of the power of the air and he's a tyrant ruling over men in an unredeemed state. He has no right to touch me. Amen. I am a son of God.
Amen.
I have the authority of a son that is only defined in the Son. It's not defined in fallen angels. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Am I messing with you? Am I taking you down the catalog too many rows? No, I'm going to grab a hold of you and get you to start thinking heavenly, divinely, in Christ Jesus. What he's doing is what you're doing. If he's not doing it, you're not doing it. Your life is hid away in him. When Christ, who is your life, set your affections on things above, not on things of this earth. That's not worldly. That is earthy, natural. 401k, retirement. Limitations, yeah. Insurance, what happens when we get sick?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, don't mess with my insurance policy. Have your insurance policy. It's purely natural. It's nothing to do with faith. It's nothing to do with the Spirit.
That's right.
Nothing. It limits you and confines you in the realms of fear. He's not giving us the spirit of fear. Huh?
Yes.
Sure. We've not received the spirit of bondage to fear again, but we've received the spirit of the Son, whereby we say, God is my daddy.
Yes.
That is purely spiritual. That is a spiritual mind, a spiritual thing. It is not natural. It has nothing to do with a natural framework of thinking as you've been taught since you were in preschool and very conditioned as you received the lobotomy by 12th grade to now have to totally unthink and relearn everything. The weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God. To the pulling down,
yes.
Strongholds, casting down logizimos, the logic, rational thinking of men, the natural realm of thinking. God wants you to deal with the natural realm of thinking. He wants you to deal with things that have set up in your mind and your thinking. And then I said, we're not talking about, you know, people just got so wrapped up in the immoral, they just like, everything they talk about strongholds and this and that, and it's all some demonic thing. No, it's just thinking as mere men, living as mere men. When you divine people,
yeah.
Huh? When you're in the kingdom of God, you're the witnesses of heaven.
Amen.
You're the ministers of reconciliation. You're the sons of God.
Amen.
Somebody says, I want to be an apostle. Well, you're a son. You're son and a daughter of the Most High. I mean, you can't get any higher title than that.
Amen.
The rest of it is just kind of like extras. You know what I'm saying? Come on, people. I want you to grab a hold of this. Yeah. Your identity in Christ. Jesus said, Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them. So they can be one just like we're one. And he's not talking about you and me being one. Forget about it. He's saying, Father, as you are in me and I'm in you, I in them and they in us. He defined oneness and he defined glory in that oneness. He defined that day. You'll know that the Father is in me and that I'm in you and that you are in me.
Amen.
That day, purely spiritual, nothing natural about it. Start thinking natural. I wonder, is it time to prophesy yet? Natural thinking. You got to be raptured away, caught away in praise and thanksgiving for prophecy to just come out in that flow. The endowment of God's divine power, the freedom of where you now, as I was saying earlier, not being drunk with wine where in his excess, but be continually filled with the Spirit. Being filled with the Spirit is the same as being baptized in the Holy Spirit. He said, you'll be baptized not many days from now. And when they were there getting ready to be baptized, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. So what's the difference between baptism and filling? Nothing. What does it mean to be baptized? What's the difference between being baptized in the Spirit and being filled with the Spirit? Absolutely nothing. Remember what John said, I baptize you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days yet. Acts 1:5, Acts 2:4, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
There's more than that. I'm not going to get into it. I love trying to blow up everybody's little whatevers, you know.
Thank you.
It's just, it took you here. He just wants to continually baptize us. He wants to continually overwhelm us with his presence, overwhelmed by his presence. Walking in the manifest presence of God, living out a relationship with the living God, seeing that the Holy Ghost is with us and in us. That's purely spiritual thinking. God wants you to be able to discern the spiritual. But we are not judged or discerned by any man. Because nobody in the natural thinking can come along and correct us about how we walk on the water. Nobody in the natural thinking can come along and correct us about how we call finances into our bank accounts. No one can come along in the natural and correct us about how we do signs and wonders and miracles.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
For we have, look at the last, that verse 16, for we have the mind of Christ. Paul's calling us to the place. We have the mind of the spiritual realm. Peter said we are a spiritual house built up by the Holy Ghost to offer spiritual sacrifices in 1 Peter chapter 2. Paul addressed it. He said, be covetous for the spiritual. Understand this. I know it's, go look at me. Go look at me. Go look with me quickly in 1 Corinthians. Nothing's quickly around here. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Somebody said the church service go too long. You should have been in Paul's meeting.
Yeah.
Eutychus got his name in the Bible for falling asleep in the meeting. It's true. Fell asleep. He was sitting in had a terrible chair in the window. Fell out of the window.
Yeah.
right in the middle of Paul was a long time preaching. That's what it says. Paul was a long day preaching. Falls out of the window. I mean, God, I can't wait to meet Eutychus. I'm like, man, you became a hero in the faith by falling asleep in the church. You got your name in the Bible, man. You became a highlight for falling asleep in church. He falls out the window and kills himself. He dies. Paul goes down, raises him from the dead. Hallelujah. And continues to preach until morning. What a Holy Ghost meeting. See, if you've ever been around revivalists, which I am, Holy Ghost people, they are a long time in the meeting. It's purely spiritual. Mama used to say that your mind cannot endure more than your bottom can. sitting in the chair. Huh? But I told Mama, listen, we'll get them from the natural into the spiritual and they'll forget all about their bottom. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. We'll get them to think a new way. To think a new way. Purely spiritual. That I have the righteousness of God. That I am created in righteousness and true holiness. Purely spiritual. Purely the mind of Christ. Faith. Purely spiritual. This is the power that overcomes the world. This is the divine power. Even your faith. Purely spiritual. Belongs. It has nothing in the realms of the natural. Everything in the natural testifies against it. Nothing about the natural can receive it or understand it or accept it or work it into the equation, because after all, I'm in pain. I'm hurting right now. I'm in fear. Perfect love will cast out that fear. Amen. The life and the power of God will flood through your being, and everything that was dead and everything that was dying will become a fruitful garden of Eden. It's true. It's entirely spiritual. You have to lay hold on an unseen realm.
Yes,
purely spiritual. God has purposed to remain in an unseen realm for his divine purposes, because he wants us to go be developed something beyond the five senses, which is purely a natural realm, to now begin to have developed spiritual senses, hallelujah, that has nothing to do with the seeing of the eye and the hearing of the ear, the natural ear, or anything that belongs to that sense realm that you can conclude out of a natural existence. Not just an unredeemed state, a natural existence. And double parallelisms exist throughout the Bible, from Genesis all the way through Revelation. Where there's double applications to things. And hopefully you can see very clearly that you do not have to limit the natural and the spiritual in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 to an unregenerated state versus regenerator, unredeemed versus redeemed, because Paul's talking to redeemed, the redeemed, using the same terminology. He's talking to the redeemed, talking about a natural body. I have a natural body. Huh? But it's his.
Amen.
It's the temple of God. Amen. Hear that? I got a new definition. It's not this vile, corruptible thing that causes me to be constantly drug into sin and iniquity. No, no. It's where I'm glorifying him. And that's not an obligation. I'm empowered.
Amen.
I tell my body, get to glorify pain. You get to glorify God right now. Get out of my body now in Jesus' name. Huh? Elizabeth. She's my sweet darling. And so she gets sick or whatever, growing up, I say, you foul spirit of sickness, go. Or I would just look at her and I say, now you listen to me right now. You will not be sick anymore. I talk to her just like she's getting ready to get in spanking for being in trouble. Well, one day, she was throwing up. The Sunday morning, she's out there, she's throwing up. Mom comes out of the car, I said, where's Elizabeth? She's very, very sick. I said, in the name of Jesus, healed now. And she didn't respond. And I'm thinking, whoa, what's up here? So I said, you know, I just talked to the Lord, and she said, and the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, said, it's time for her to start using her own faith.
Amen.
So I walked up to the door and I said, Elizabeth, baby, you don't have to come to the meeting. You can stay home. She came charging out. She says, there's no way I'm staying home. Huh? She's still sick, still nauseated. Huh? She's going to go up to the platform now. She's not going to sit on the back seat just in case she's got to go. She's going to go up on the platforms because she's on the worship team. You stepped at the platform, instantly healed. You have to be willing to go all the way. You got to run the risk of throwing up in front of everybody. Right while you're on the microphone. Oh, Faith, listen, Faith increases. Faith grows. But it's purely spiritual. It's grabbing hold of the Word. God's Word is spiritual. He said, my Word is spirit and life. Spiritual. Spiritual. It's another realm. It's not in the predictable human condition and under Newtonian physics. God forbid, quantum. Hydrogen bonding isn't the same in the spiritual. It's not the same. There's nothing the same. Diseases don't function the same in the spiritual. Amen. John G. Lake can say, I prove it to you. My body is the temple of the living God. He believed this. He was completely given over to his body being the temple of the living God. He wasn't wondering about it anymore. He wasn't locked somewhere between the natural and the spiritual, trying to bend or lean towards the spiritual. He gave Satan no wiggle room. Wiggle room. He's a wiggle worm too. He said, put the plague on my hand. Yeah. It will die when it touches me. John G. Lake, he was the experimentalist of the miracle power of God. He was. He was the experimentalist of the miracle power of God. Today, John G. Lake, the apostolic faith movement in Africa, if they're going to have a convention, I'm going to tell you right now, hundreds of thousands of people, millions of people, in just a small region. If you got everybody together, what one man's faith was able to do to a nation, what one man's faith, which is purely spiritual faith, you cannot talk in terms of the natural. It can, it will, if the natural is imposed upon it at all, it will not work. It doesn't work. It's something that only the Holy Spirit supplies to us because we're willing to know in our heart that it is done and speak it with their mouth and watch even mountains be removed into the sea or whatever I say, it's going to happen. Yes. You need to practice.
Yes.
Practice.
Hallelujah.
You need to practice. Practice on yourself. Yes. Throw your aspirin out. Yes. Throw your NyQuil out.
Yes.
Get rid of your ibuprofens, huh? Yes. And all of your other elixirs. And snake oils, huh?
Amen.
Just go ahead and start believing God. Come on.
Amen.
Watch how you have authority over pain.
Amen.
Because pain is a means by which sickness tries to set up its residence in your life.
Amen.
Watch God work through you supernaturally by the power of his word and of his faith that is in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Baby, I don't know where Allie is with baby right now. Where's she at?
Training ground.
Oh, she's in the training ground. She's in boot camp, spiritual boot camp right now. She's misbehaving a little bit, so she has to go to spiritual boot camp. That's way where we can pare all the things down, break it down in various terminology that can be more understood. You know, kind of thing. Okay. But at any rate, okay, spiritual. I get a call from the hospital. Allie's on her deathbed. Baby, they're going to have to take baby. Baby's 27 weeks? And don't know that either one of them can be resuscitated. There's this HELLP syndrome, it's attacked Allie. And finally stopped. Whole body shuts down, vital signs shut down, everything. Baby becomes a non-self in your body, attacks your entire immune system. Weird. Demonic. Huh? And you know, and the enemy tries to do this, and if we don't know our authority, see, he's rebellious. He's rebellious. He don't believe God. He don't obey God. Is he going to obey you or believe you? Give me a break. Obey you and believe you. You're going to have to know yourself some authority.
That's right.
Amen.
Purely spiritual. You give him any room, I'm there right now, he's going to run right over top of you. He's going to bulldoze you down.
Right.
Listen. So, you know, we were imposing some pretty intense threats against the kingdom of darkness when northern China and up in North Korea and come home and this is what's going on. Ann and I walk into the hospital And I get drunk in the Holy Ghost. I'm getting drunk on the way. I'm getting drunk. I get into the hospital. I am drunk in the Holy Ghost. We are not drunk with wine as you suppose. But this is Boltaranea. So they tell me Allie's going to die, and I'm busting up laughing. I'm laughing. No, she's fine. No, you don't understand. They're trying to give me this list of clinical stuff. Somebody told them that I was somebody. I knew something, and so they're trying to run this thing down for me. And I'm just laughing. Now they've lost respect for me. They're considering calling security. They're not coming up and giving me any reports. They're walking around me, like this. I'm caught away in the purely in the spiritual. There's no way that the baby's going to be able to make it if we can just, we're going to pull the baby, take the baby out once we can get her vital signs, once we can get her stabilized. And I'm telling you right now, we have proofs and evidence that they did not expect the baby to live and that they did not expect her to live. By the way, that they cut her open. It's ridiculous. It's crazy. In one of premier hospitals. I'm laughing. I'm caught away, purely spiritual, taken away by the Holy Ghost because I've given myself to Him. So He's a master of my life. He's in control of me. He doesn't have to ask me permission to come in and fill me with faith, where no fear can get in.
Amen.
And of course, baby's almost 6 years old now. She was born 1 pound, 3 ounces. Huh? Hallelujah. Kerishomanekana. Over and over. You don't do that with a natural thinking. I sat down with the doctor and I said, you know, I'd read the doctor's bio. I told him, you know, I told him where he went to school, where he went to med school. I told him, you know, where he did his internship and what he did his residency in. You know, I laid out his bio. He goes, well, he said, you've done research on me. Allie's dad sitting across the table, a lawyer, and, you know, he's listening. He's very, you know, accommodating guy, trying to bring everybody together kind of guy, you know. And I said, guys, I just want you to know, I respect your education and that you did well in school. And I know you had to spend a lot of time learning what you've learned. I respect that. But you got to respect me. I'm a servant of the Most High God.
Amen.
You got to respect the authority of Christ Jesus. Amen. To command the wind and the waves, to say to the sick and the diseased, be healed. Amen. To say to the body, function and live when everything... Because they're trying to tell me they got to do this and they got to do that. And they're putting pressure on Josh Manali. And I'm saying, you tell them no, 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 and no in Jesus' name. But if you don't do this, she's going to die. Brain bleeds, pulmonary disease, just all these crazy things that she's going to be. She's going to be on a, you know, a ventilator for the rest of her life. Just painting the worst thing. No, no. Once again, I respect your training. I respect all that you learn from men, but it has no relevance here. Natural, spiritual.
Amen.
I have no respect for doctors when it comes to them denying God. I have all respect for God and no respect for anyone else. I have no respect for me when I have something to say different from what God has to say. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Am I getting the difference between the natural and the spiritual?
Yes.
To recognize that you, even being born again, can lock yourself into a place of being a babe in a manger, as it were. A little baby, a little child. And if you look at little children, as what Paul says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 1, and you compare it to what he said in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 14, you recognize those are the folks that are constantly being tripped up, tricked, and overwhelmed by every circumstance and every trick of men. Or you can grow and mature in the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. Which one are you going to be? Child, carnal, natural thinking, a natural thinker, trying to figure it all out, trying to work it all out? Or are you going to learn how to yield to the Spirit of the Lord and flow in the Holy Ghost? So listen, just real quickly, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, follow after divine love and desire the spiritual. Not spiritual gifts. Gifts is not there. Somebody felt the need who never experienced one spiritual gift in their life, who never in one life, their lifetime, functioned in the gifts of the Spirit, felt an urgency to put in gifts because they didn't know what on earth Paul's talking about. He's talking about the spiritual. He's talking about the realms of the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, living in the Spirit. What does that mean? Divine help. For a second, Akashi, can never talk bad about a person ever again. Ah, the laws of the Spirit of life, spiritual laws, now in effect. If we no longer want to be limited by the natural physical laws. Are you listening to me? Can you hear? Do that. Won't help much. Open up my ears and cause me to hear. Because I'm stuck on thinking like I like to think. I'm stuck on my brilliance. I'm stuck on delighting in all that I know. That's Satan's downfall. He was brilliant in his own eyes. He really had it all figured out. He really understood everything. And then nothing. God wants to teach you that you can walk on water, that you can live in divine health, that you can take authority over pain that is imposing itself upon you. I'm going to talk, I'm trying to talk every one of you into being healed tonight. I'm trying to talk every one of you into being filled and functioning in spiritual gifts and not, once again, waiting for another, I don't know how long, or some event, I don't know what you're waiting for, to be caught away. Let me help you, some of you get tired at night. And it's hard to flow in the anointing when you're tired. Because, once again, the natural and the physical is trying to impose itself on the supernatural. You can bust through that. Amen. You bust through that and you can start flowing in the gifts of the Spirit.
Amen.
Don't bust through that. You let it dominate over your life. You're stuck. Well, I don't know how. You need to get desperate.
Amen.
You need to get zealous. Get zealous.
Amen.
Be zealous.
Amen.
Be zealous of the spiritual. Verse 12. Even so, you for as much as you are zealous of the spiritual. What is he talking about specifically there? You know? That's what he's talking about. Well, that's crazy talk. For the natural, that's crazy talk. Specifically, what he's talking about is Topromanti Antalanamaste. He that speaks in an unknown tongue speaks not unto men, but unto God. It's purely spiritual, it's the language of the Spirit. It's another dimension. It's another conversation going on. He says, seeing as you're zealous for the spiritual, he says also, seek that you may excel into edifying the church.
Yes.
He says, let toro misiara manai, excel into interpretation of tongues, or excel into prophecy, or really excel into a message in tongues, where now you're not speaking to God, but speaking to men. See a transition? See the transition?
Yeah.
He that speaks in unknown tongues, he that speaks in the language of the Spirit, speaks not unto men, but unto God. How be it? He speaks mystery in the spiritual. If you go look at literal Greek translations and understand, I hope you parse out some of these words. It's purely spiritual. Speaking in the realms of the Spirit is spiritual. He's teaching. God the Holy Ghost, the teacher, has come to show us how to quit functioning in the natural realm, being limited to the natural realm and the natural thinking, which is based upon natural laws that we've been taught how to think, especially in a Western society, how to think like Greeks. We are Roman Greco society. Hmm? Remember the Alexandrian kingdom of brass? Right?
Yes.
Right? From which the Antichrist kingdom will emerge. Remember? And the legs of Rome of iron. Huh? Which will also rise in the last day. The Greco-Roman Empire and its culture that is Antichrist in spirit and nature, anti-God, demonically designed, is the culture that still exists in the Western world. Some of you took Western civilization in school, right? I almost said in church. It's in church too. Natural thinking. It's nothing to do with the mind of Christ. It's nothing to do with the mind of the Spirit. It has nothing to do with the reality. It has nothing to do with truth. Your reality is defined on the basis of what you believe truth to be. I can take you into Iri and Jaya, and they have another reality. And it's wild. And it's crazy. And they don't lust after you like Westerners lust. They think your elbow would look good, taste good in the soup. And they're looking at you smiling. And it's because they're going to be friendly. It's because they think that, Cultures of the world. You take you to the Congo and take you some weird places, weird stuff going on. Huh? The anthropologists say, leave them alone. You say to them, you got to be kidding me. You want me to leave them alone like that? And that desperate, deplorable, spiritual state that they're in. No way, I'm going to go in there and set them free.
Amen.
Natural thing, based upon your culture. Here's reality to me.
Amen.
This is the truth.
Yes.
It defines my reality.
Yes.
It's entirely spiritual. Hmm? Natural, you can't tell mountains to be removed. It doesn't work that way. You can't tell mulberry trees to be plucked up by the roots and planted in the sea. It doesn't work that way. It will die. As it's being transplanted, the sun, the light, will kill the cells. And it will die. And then you put it in the water, and it's going to rot the roots. And it will die again. Natural thinking, predictable thinking based upon natural laws, the way things work. Yeah, I'll get you a real spiritual one out here. Are you ready? We know that everyone who is begotten of God, born of God, does not sin. Because they keep themselves and the wicked one cannot touch them. Now somebody said, is that in the Bible? Yep.
Amen.
Boy, we really need an interpreter now. We need somebody to help us. Yeah, let's help. Let me help you. Those who are born of God do not sin. Now, here's how I like to quote 1 John 5:18. We know that they knew that everyone who's born of God does not sin. Because we don't know that. Because we have integrated the Word of God with the mixture and have lost the power and the authority of the life. Ah. So we can't say with John necessarily, we know that everyone who's born of God does not sin. Actually, the whole first epistle of John is an entire mystery. And people have tried to disqualify it, but the greatest evidence of extant manuscripts being a part of the original, what we call the original autograph, or that which was signed and sealed and delivered by John, is weighted in favor of everything that John wrote. It's the oldest dated manuscripts all the way back. You can't get rid of Revelation no matter how you want to. You can't get rid of the first epistle of John no matter how desperate you are. Because he says it three times. If you're born of God, you can't sin. Well, he knew something we're having problems with. It's a Word of God realm. It's a faith realm. It's an empowerment. The words which I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Divine power. An agreement with God. Until the blind man believes that Jesus can heal him, he will remain blind.
Yes.
He can remain blind. Until the lost man believes that Jesus Christ can save him, he remains lost.
Yes.
Think about the things that we allow this natural life and what everybody says. And when you go to the doctor, it's going to get worse. It's going to get worse. Because you've given him a place of authority to speak out his lies that are purely natural, that you have, that are absolutely nothing to do with the reality of what God has said. Nothing. And if you're medical doctors, clinicians in any way, you need to quit speaking that nonsense. We need to find another way to say it. Well, the book says, or some other way to say it. And make sure you're talking about the book that men wrote. The writ of men. The writ that men wrote. Because the doctor says you're given a place of authority and now you're in bondage to it. You have to be able to say, wait a minute, it's not written in the Word. I didn't find that. What did you say again? See if I can recall that verse of Scripture. It's not written, and you're not God. And I don't know what you were doing there in the first place asking him. I hadn't had a physical checkup for years. I don't know, 20s. Last time, I think I had to do that. My close friend, Signs and Wonders Miracle Man, died of a massive heart attack before he could get into the hospital 1 year ago, the first of the year. And somebody said, well, you ought to go get a checkup. And I thought, well, I'll go get a checkup. I'm sure I'm fine, but I go get a checkup. I go to get a checkup, see, you know, how I'm doing, and the doctor listened to my heart and took my blood pressure and did a few other things like that. He says, well, as far as I can tell, you're very healthy. And he asked me about what I've been doing in my life, and I told him I'm preaching the gospel and the other things that I share. I'm thinking, what on earth am I even doing in here? And he gave me a recommendation to go to a place to get my cholesterol levels checked, and still haven't made it over there. And I'm not going to go. And I'm going to go. I'm thinking, wait a minute. Why? See, just a little bit of fear. Just a little bit of concern. Well, there's nothing wrong with going in a checkup. Many people, listen, there's nothing wrong. Don't misunderstand me. There's nothing wrong. You want to do that, do that. I mean, you know, doctors have prolonged the people's lives. And bless their hearts, they prolonged people's lives. Many of those lives didn't look like they needed to be prolonged. But some of them did need to be prolonged. I don't want to look like a zombie. I mean, quadruple bypass. You look like a quadruple bypass. You know, are you with me? I'm sorry if you've had a quadruple bypass in here. I'm sorry. Bless God. Praise God. I'm like, glad you're here. We want to get you healed. I just don't want to do that. You know, are you with me? They prolong people's life who didn't know the Lord. Give us another chance to get him in the kingdom. But do we need to be subject to that? You do if you don't know how to move in the Spirit. You do. You better go get yourself a doctor's checkup quickly. And you know, and then you say, well, how about your friend who was the miracle worker, signs and wonders guy? Look, I don't know anything about it. I know what I did. I wouldn't try to raise him from the dead because I said it was the devil. He didn't listen to me. I'm sure he's in heaven. But I gave it like 10 hours. You know, I walked in there and I said, I need to be with the body. He said, well, we thought you were coming at 11:30 to visit. I said, I'm not coming to visit. I'm coming to raise him from the dead. I need the day. They're looking at me like, what? You know? I said, hold up, because they're walking away talking among themselves. looking back, you know, woo. I said, no, no, no. She said, wait. I said, I'm a preacher of the gospel. I understand the Lord has commissioned us to go and raise the dead. I'm just doing my job here, okay? And they seem to settle out with it. They said, let us get the body ready. Oh, I just so wanted to come walking out of there with John. Have I changed my opinion about raising the dead? No, not at all. Smith Wigglesworth went into where they were doing a wake. That's, you know, where everybody's camped around the dead body.
Yeah.
And he goes in there, raised the guy from the dead. He comes walking out with the guy, got his arm around him, and everybody's sitting around still crying, didn't even recognize him. This is true. True. This is validated and verified by Holy Ghost men of God who are not liars. They didn't recognize the guy they're crying for now. The wakeover is now just laughing and talking with Smith as they're walking out the door. They took off. Left everybody there to eat lunch. They discover. Where's the body? Come on, man. I am so dedicated. I am so blessed. I mean, I had some dear people in here. They're sitting here right now, some of them. And they said, we're going to go raise the dead. And I'm like, praise God. Amen. Go for it. And they said, well, we just want to let you know. I had no idea. They said, and we're taking some clothes for them. And I said, wow, that's great. And food. I said, that's faith. I still don't get the clothes. I haven't made the connection. They're taking clothes. I had no idea. They were going to break into a mausoleum, take his ashes out on the mountaintop and pour them out and command the ashes to raise up the dead. I'm like, I have a reason to boast in the Holy Ghost now. They're now, hey, listen, Pastor, we've been praying for several hours now, and the ashes are, nothing's happening. I said, what? Ashes? Yeah, we broke into the mausoleum and got them. I don't know if we can get them. We're thinking about calling the parents who's, you know, don't call the parents. But we're not sure what's the dirt and what's the ashes. I said, just gather up whatever. Stick it back in a box and get the thing back where it's supposed to be. And I'm proud of you. And I'm praising God because I'm telling you, that is greater works. If it's not written in the Bible, it is a greater works. I am so blessed that I am preaching in such a way that inspires the moving out in the realms of the spiritual. Come on. Because if you don't stop and if you don't let up, believe me, we have been standing there. Ann and I have been standing there in awe of the power of God in third world countries especially. We've watched every miracle take place, except for I have not been used by the Lord to raise the dead. God has used me to bring people out of comas, that people have been deep in comas, to just walk up and touch them and say to them, get up, sweetie. That's just that it. Suddenly they awake. Things of that nature. But as far as I know, I've never been used by God to raise the dead yet. But I'm going to be used by. I've had dreams where I've gone down to downtown San Diego, to the Morgan, downtown San Diego, and pulled out every one of those trays saying, get up, get up, get up, get up. Everybody's getting up from the dead. Everybody, no matter what they died of, it's going to happen. Yeah. I am pressing in there. It's purely spiritual. I will not be limited by some experience that said it can't happen, or that somehow God's word has changed, or the dynamics of it is different. I'm contending for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. I'm pressing into a realm.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise. That's why we're preaching so long. That's why I'm talking to you about the natural. This is not academic.
No.
I'm trying to break down for you the things that are imposing itself upon you so that you're not thinking right.
Amen.
So that you're not agreeing with God and moving past all the assailing thoughts and imaginations or rational thinking or logics of men. The atmosphere gets so supercharged outside of the United States of America, and it's going to happen in America.
Amen. Amen.
to where we see hundreds and thousands of even of people instantaneously, all simultaneously, at the very moment of just saying hello, delivered from every kind of evil spirit. To watch them go from complete insanity to complete normal.
Amen.
Manic, depressive, schizophrenics, on and on. Just stand up in their right mind, clothing in their right mind, testifying of what Jesus did and their visitation. It's going to happen in America. These things are going to be prevented for just so long. It's the atmosphere. And it's really even more than just the atmosphere of what everybody has agreed to within the framework of the church and the unbelief and the doubt that is opposing the miracle-working power of the name of Jesus Christ. It is the things that people allow their thoughts to think on and their limitations on God that they place there. The miracle's here. It's already here.
Amen.
It's already here.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Desire this realm of heaven.
Yeah.
Because that's the spiritual. It's living in heaven. Desire this realm of walking in the Spirit, being led by the Spirit. Living in the Spirit. Moving with Him. As many as are moving with the Spirit, led by the Spirit, they're the sons of God.
Amen.
Functioning as the sons of God.
Amen.
Lord, I want to be so sensitive to hearing everything you say, doing it your way.
Amen.
You see our hearts, oh God. Do it now.
Now.
Greater works now.
Now.
Let the glory of heaven, let the fire of your presence so fall upon Southern California.
Yes.
Everybody
yes.
shakes,
yes.
shakes,
yes.
shakes. Under the power of Holy Ghost conviction.
Amen.
Not by words of men's wisdom, not by reasoning, not by explanations, but by a supernatural invasion of the force of God's divine power.
Yes.
That's great awakenings. Great awakenings don't come because these movings of God, these sovereign movings of God, don't come because of all the things that we do within the framework of human effort. It comes because we diligently cry out to God and say, Father, send your fire now. A few people in a small church that would be smaller than this one little section right here. Smaller than this one little section. And usually the average attendance was about 10 to 12 people. Came and cried out, oh God, send your fire. Oh God, send your fire. Oh God, I've built your altar. I've laid your wood upon your altar according to your word. Sacrifice is ready. Send you fire now. See, the fire only falls upon the sacrifice that is that which God has designed and ordained, which is perfect, tamim, without blemish. Yeah. Then the fire falls. Yeah. If there's something wrong with the offering, fire didn't fall. That is the premise of the entire offerings of the Bible. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, Father's made us a holy and acceptable offering for the fire to fall. This is in Wells, September the 27th and the 28th, 1904. Evan Roberts crying, oh God, send your fire now. And suddenly a sovereign moving of God swept over and descended upon a nation of Wells. And the place shook under the power. It didn't matter who you were, whether you were an agnostic, an atheist, whether you were an academician, a policeman, a drunkard, the nation shook under the power of God. See, I see that. I feel that. Therefore, I can lay hold on it, and I'm not discouraged. I'm contending for it. I see something that is not within the realms of what I see with my eyes or experience within the framework of my interactions with men. I know that God is going to get his boast and his only begotten son in Southern California. And the things that happen, I mean, I know that Amy Simple McPherson came and I believe it was in the 20s or in the 30s, and she drove through Balboa Park, and they laid the sick out all over Balboa Park, and as she drove, she just held her hand at the window. And people in mass were being healed. And she just held her hand out the window. What was going on? A moving of God, a sovereign moving of God. Of signs and wonders in the gifts of healing. I'm just practicing with my shadow right now. Where is that shadow? There she is. Think about it. I mean, where do you see your limitation? Oh, my, Peter's shadow can do it, but mine can't. Natural thinking, the limitation after your own belief system of who you believe yourself to be and how you perceive yourself, rather than seeing yourself as identified by God and patterned and after everyone who ever moved in God. So stand up. So go ahead, stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Hallelujah. Hey, Anna, come up here, baby. Come up here just a second. Wave a bit. Come up here. Just, no, Mom, just, no, Mom. Come up here. Just come up here quickly. Wave at everybody. Say hello.
Hello.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Baby's supposed to have all kinds of problems. She's the smartest little thing I know. She's brilliant. We love her so much. Were you in training, sweetheart? Did you go to training school with Mom? Huh? We love you, darling. I saw you on the video clip praying over people, saying fire, more of Jesus, and they've fallen out under the anointing. Amen. You love praying for people, don't you, baby?
Yeah.
She's signs and wonders girl. How old was she one night in the meeting?
9 months.
Huh?
9 months old. When she started
saying hallelujah. 9 months old. I'm telling you. And most of you are witnesses to this.
Yes.
Perfectly articulating over and over again.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Not even possible for her from a physical realm, a natural realm, physiological realm, for her to be even able to pronounce that. Hallelujah. 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 Isn't he wonderful? Isn't Jesus wonderful? She's a holy woman of God.
Amen.
Born for signs and wonders and miracles.
Amen.
She's a little tiny thing. But she's big in spirit.
Amen.
Watch what God's going to do through my baby. Come give Papa a hug. Miss Spitzbergen. Love you, baby. Your little brother about to get here? Huh? Little brother coming? Do you have any needs tonight? You feel good? From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet? Are you healthy? Strong and healthy? Praise God. Yes, you are. You want to help Papa pray for some people tonight? Okay. I believe that we should pray for anybody who has pain or sickness in their body. Huh? Anybody who has pain or sickness in your body and you believe you're going to get healed right now, you can come. Christ the healer is here. Christ the healer is here. Christ the healer is here. He loves you, dear. He loves you, dear. What do you need? What do you need? Huh? Hmm? Here, let me turn this off. He's going to break off every addiction off your life. Look at me. He's going to do it. Fear and the torment's going to leave you. Command your foot to be healed in Jesus' name. Every addiction goes now in Jesus' name. Yeah? That's right. No more desire for tobacco? None? None? That goes from you? He loves you dearly. He does. He does. tonight, right now. I was just recently contacted by this girl. And I just reminded, because I know I have probably not such a good breath. And she came up and she said, because I saw her and kind of the same thing that happened to me when I saw you. And I said, so what is it that you need the Lord to do? She said, well, I don't have an olfactory nerve. I've never smelled anything in my life. And her parents were sitting there. And I said, smell this. And the first thing she smelled was my bad breath. Isn't God so good?
Yes.
So every bit of pain goes out of your body. The one advantage I had with her is no one ever prayed for her for a miracle before. She basically was just a Baptist kind of girl, you know. And the Lord Jesus can easily heal Baptists. Methodists, Episcopalian, it takes a little bit longer to heal Pentecostals. And that's only because all the Pentecostals are already supposed to be walking in divine health anyways. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, what's your name? Tiffany. Tiffany, just raise your hands towards Jesus. Let the Spirit of the Lord touch you. All the anxiety and all the fear and all the torment and all the affliction of the past and everything that Satan has tried to impose upon your life to destroy your life. It's undone. It's undone. It's undone. It's destroyed, not reversed. Destroyed. God brings forth a new thing here. Amen. Tiffany. A new thing. It's a glorious thing. A joyous thing. In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, I thank you that you overwhelm Tiffany's life with your goodness and with your glory, and that you bless everything about her life from this day forward, that all the days upon this earth that she lives will be filled with all this wonderful life that only you can give. Thank you, Jesus. Sealing it now. Seal it now. Right in your body. Right in your body right now. Right in your body right now in Jesus' name. Right in your body right now in Jesus' name. Right into your body right now in Jesus' name. Right into your body right now in Jesus' name. Blessed Jesus. Blessed right now. Healed in Jesus' name. Healed. Healed. Yesterday won't be like tomorrow. Tomorrow won't be like yesterday means. Tomorrow won't be like yesterday. It's a new day. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I speak into your life, healing. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Every fear and every torment and every lie of the enemy that has harassed you and plagued you, they are no longer going to be rational thoughts of your mind, but assailing thoughts from the enemy of your soul. You're going to take up the authority that God has given you, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And you're going to speak out the life of God. And you're going to allow the Spirit of the Lord to develop you and make you strong in faith, in divine authority, to deal with every opposing power of darkness from this day forward in the name of Jesus. The chain is broken. Lorostaneki lamakatai.
Hilt.
Missisht. Morisavina. Mikia tadakania. Hilt. Morisdikishta montapanani. Istini matiha. Healed in Jesus' name. Busterena, Mandeli. Iroshande, Irupana, Aluka. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Ha. Bon deste. Claire, what's wrong? Claire, what's wrong?
My chest has been.
Now, in the name of Jesus, it has no right to hurt. Now, in Jesus' name, your chest is not hurting you no more. Ever. Do you hear me? I'm the pastor, you have to obey. Healed! It don't hurt now. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the fiery anointing of the Holy Ghost upon your daughter. I thank you for great signs and wonders and miracles work through her life. Lord, I thank you for this great outpouring of your Spirit. It's your daughter. In Jesus' name. Sio Manisa. Now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, and deep into your belly, deep into the very being of your body, healed. So, what, do you have an abscess? What's going on with you? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I curse this infection in Jesus' name. And I command it to cease existing. Dies. Dies right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. Send it away. Send it away. Send it away, daughter of the Most High God, send it away. Send it away. Send it away. Send it away. God wants to work a great miracle for anybody in this place tonight who's never been born again. Jesus said, you cannot understand the kingdom of God, encounter the kingdom of God, see the kingdom of God, unless you're born again. He's talking to a Jewish man, a ruler of the Jews, when he says it. It turns his world upside down because this man thought that through his obedience to the law and through the keeping of his religious system, he could enter in the kingdom of God, and Jesus invalidated it all. Somebody said, well, it seems like the Christians are all narrow-minded. They think it's only their way. No. That's like saying, that it's wrong or ridiculous that it takes a man and a woman to have a child. It's the law. It's the only way it works. No one can come into the kingdom of God unless they are made a new creature, a new creation. No religion, no power on earth except for the name of Jesus can work that miracle. Tonight, God is calling you. Everyone who hears the sound of my voice, whether you're in this room, or you're watching on the web, or you're watching on YouTube, Jesus has stepped into your life and he says to you, you must be born again. You must be born of the Spirit. You must be born of the water, which is simply to say that the life of God comes and fills you and changes you and gives you a new heart and a new spirit so you can know him. So that no longer the bondage of sin and the plagues of death be able to have its authority over your life. He wants to liberate you and set you free and bring you into a realm of his life and liberty. All you have to do is respond and say, I want this life. The woman at the well said, oh, evermore give me this water to drink. Evermore give me this water that's living, so that the Spirit of the living God can spring up on the inside of me and fill me with all of God's life. Tonight, if you want to be filled with God's life, if you want every chain of death and sin to be broken off of you, Christ Jesus, right now, he's here. If you're a backslider, if you've been wayward, if you've not been walking with God, Christ Jesus stands at the door of your heart, banging on your heart right now, even saying to those that have walked away from him, saying, listen, open up the door. I'll come in and sup with you. I'll come in and enter into a place of relationship with you once again. Amen. All you have to do is turn your heart towards heaven. Yes. Tonight, there are people in here, perhaps you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. God has poured out his Spirit, the gift of the Holy Ghost, upon everyone who would obey him. Father takes us into a whole new dimension of authority over all sickness and over all disease. I mean, the born-again believer has authority. Well, my goodness, when you baptize in the Holy Ghost and fire, it goes to a whole nother level. A whole nother dimension, forgive me. It goes to a whole nother dimension. What do you want God to do for you? There's people standing in here tonight. You've never been able to flow in the gifts of the Spirit. You do pretty good at home in your closet or driving in your car, but as soon as you get around people, you shut down. Father wants to deliver you from that self-consciousness and that human restraint. Let him touch you now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let him touch you now. He loves you. God has decreed a great blessing upon you. God has decreed authority in your life. Power and authority in your life. He's decreed it. These things of heaven are yours right now. 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 Right now, be filled. Right now, be filled. Right now, be filled. Right now, be filled. Right now, be filled and begin to speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Right now, be filled. Right now, let the rivers of living water begin to flood your soul, flood your being. Right now, let God step in and overwhelm you with his life and with his goodness. Right now, receive a refreshing from on high. Ha-ha! Right now, let the power of God sweep through your soul. Let the power of God sweep through your spirit. Let faith come. Let boldness come. Let the overcoming power of life and faith flood your soul down. Hallelujah. 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 I want to pray for anyone who's had any kind of heart trouble. Maybe you haven't had heart trouble recently, but you've had pains in your heart. You've dealt with heart issues, concerns over your cardiovascular health. I want to pray for you right now. The Lord will heal you. Lift your hands towards heaven. Lift your hands towards heaven. Jesus touches you right now. The anointing's all over you. In Jesus' name. Heart trouble? No. Who? Have you been having heart trouble? In the name of Jesus, no little random pains. No more. You know, the Lord showed me, He said, men's hearts fail them for fear. And when He spoke that to me, you have me understand that stress, which is a daughter of fear, is a big part of people developing cardiovascular disease and heart trouble. Don't you allow fear and torment.
Amen.
Tiffany, you're never going to have anxiety and fear and torment ever again.
Amen.
It's broken off of you.
Amen.
Your house is cleaned up, Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen.
All you have to do is just throw yourself upon Him. I'm telling you right now, He cares for you. I promise you, you just rely on Him. You just say, Lord Jesus, I'm yours. Lord, I look for your strength. I look for your help. I look for your protection. I look for your perfection. I look for your provision. I'm yours. I promise you, He's going to take good care of you.
Yes.
He's going to take good care of you. Put your hands towards heaven. God is all powerful. He's almighty. There's nothing that He cannot do. Every word that proceeded out of His mouth is altogether faithful and true. And He watches over His word to hasten it. And He hastens it in you. The wind just blew. Wind. It's not about getting God to do something for you. It's yielding to what He's done.
Yes.
I said it's yielding to what He's done.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus, those opposing thoughts, those opposing lies against the truth that abound the hearts and minds of men in this place is broken. I release you from it in Jesus' name. Fill yourself with the Word of God.
Yes. Hallelujah.
So those thoughts can't find no home no more. Hallelujah. Break off the yoke. I break off the yoke tonight. I break off the yoke up for you in Jesus' name. I break off the yoke. Hallelujah. Some of you going for a double dip tonight. Hallelujah. Shirobane eche puta aslipo eche mutata risikupa. He mumpane. He mumpane. Lo saparopa. Lo saparopa. Milambroskine. Thank you, Jesus. I said, thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Ah. Ekumenaya. Ekumeneo. Your heart completely repaired. Repaired. Repair! Listen to this. A woman said in this meeting, and she said, well, the doctor's pastor said that my battery has gone out in my pacemaker. And they said, the doctor said that it has to, I have to have surgery and it has to be replaced now. I said, you don't have to. That's all I said, you didn't have to. 6 years later, several months ago, she was convinced to go in for a physical. Her battery was completely dead in her pacemaker, but her heart was totally normal. That's busting through a lot of fear. That's busting through a lot of natural thinking. All fear comes in the realms primarily of natural thinking. Satan gets in there and he also throws in the demonic realm, okay? But it wasn't a devil that caused you to fear when the lion roared. Do you understand me? You understand? It wasn't the devil that called you to fear when the rattlesnake rattled. Are you understanding me?
Yes.
It's just natural thinking.
Yes.
Which is not so bad in some respects. When it comes to people who do not know the Lord. But those who know the Lord, well, quiet kitty cat. Huh? Think about it, dude. Father would like to train you to raise the dead. To speak to nations.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you right now, I am convinced that just like Nepal was swept by the power of the Holy Ghost, so Kashmir will.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
One. One. Purely spiritual. Purely the mind of the Spirit. God's working a miracle for you right now. I can feel it. We better get the rest of it done right over here. They put her on a treadmill, normal. They had her do all kinds of things, normal. The report was, your battery's dead, but your heart's normal. How about all the well-wishers that come on? Oh, you, let's see, operation is so simple. It won't take that long. It's just a little old battery. You've already gone this far with it. And besides that, you know. Right? The death threats, right? I want to apply that to you in your circumstance. What you're going through and how you're going to deal with it. We overcome with the word of our testimony, the blood of the Lamb, and that we love not our life unto the death. What's your name? Huh?
Ahmad.
Ahmad? Where are you from?
I'm from San Diego.
From San Diego? Well, I'm glad you're here. What was wrong with your body? They said you wouldn't make it past 10 years old. What was wrong? An enlarged heart. Father, we thank you that Ahmad, right, only has an enlarged heart for you. And that, spiritually, and that his physical heart is normal. And it becomes just exactly what it's supposed to be. So you're just already a walking, living miracle, eh? So you've been living for Jesus? Okay, stay back. Be a mighty man of God. Be a man of the Spirit. Be a man of faith. Be a man of signs and wonders and miracles. Let Father show you the unseen. Walk like Elijah, like Enoch, like Daniel, like all the mighty men of faith, and more so like Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Upon my brother, upon your servant. Your heart's fine, my brother. Your heart's fine. What's up? You having a heart problem?
Not right now, but then before.
You were? Like anxiety? Stress?
It may be a cause of stress, yeah.
Well, you're not going to have that anymore.
Amen.
Servant of the Most High, Raphael.
Amen.
So is this the first time you fasted this long?
I went my longest stretch in the beginning of the fast.
Okay.
And then I took a break. And now I'm in.
Right. Is this the first time you ever fasted like this?
Yeah, it's the first time.
I promise you, listen, Raphael, it's never going to be the same for you.
Amen.
I promise you, it's a whole new realm of faith.
Amen.
It's a whole new realm of walking in the Spirit. It's a whole new realm of glory. A whole new realm of power with God. Jesus. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What's up? What's up? What's up? Tonight, why don't every person in this place decide that they are going to consecrate themselves to living in the realms of heaven? There is no substitute for a consecrated life. He set us apart so that we may, with our own will, be consecrated to that realm, to live in that realm, because it's just so good. There is no sickness there. There is no pain there. There is no disease there. There is no sorrow there. Somebody said, well, you're invalidating my Christian experience. No, I'm not. I'm calling you out of a natural realm into a spiritual. I'm calling you into a place of thinking different. I'm calling you into this wonderful place where you say, God, it is now, not later.
Amen.
It is the way God said it is.
Amen.
And now He defines for me what I think, what I feel, who I am, what I do.
Amen.
Nothing else.
Amen.
Nothing else. I have a power and authority over all sickness and diseases.
Amen.
First and foremost in my own body and in my own life. And then everywhere else that I see it working its evil work. Father, we thank you for such great movings. Listen. We are co-laborers with Christ of His husbandry and of His building. And when we are willing to put our hand to building things the way that He established them to be built, when we are willing to give ourselves over to seeing the fruit produced that He demands, when He moves sovereignly and comes as the early and the latter rain in His great movings and outpourings, we'll be right there together with Him in it.
Amen.
And those things that you've been contending for will just explode in your life.
Amen.
To a whole other dimension.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. And I just want to say this. I'm not done yet. I'm praying for this, but I just want to say this because, and I'm going to use the situation. There's a woman of faith in here, a wonderful, mighty woman of faith in here. And she called me up the other day. And she was having this assailing, tormenting thoughts. And she's saying, well, I'm having these questions and these. I said, will you just stop that right now? Will you just begin to take a hold of what Christ Jesus did for you at Calvary? Quit acting like you got to add something to it. And she was having high blood pressure with all these things going on, these thoughts. I said, would you quit trying to add to your righteousness, to His righteousness, and your work, to His work of grace? And she goes, how could have I been listening? How could have I been even hearing such a thing? It just got shut down because she was easy to talk to. Not stubborn or hard-headed, resisting the Holy Ghost. It's easy to talk to. And her blood pressure went to normal. And her faith soared. She became that much more dedicated at shutting down harassing, tormenting thoughts. I wasn't really able to get all the way there of dealing with the thoughts tonight. But I want to make it real simple for you. If it's not a God thought, don't allow it.
Amen.
If it's not a God thought, if it's not what God the Holy Spirit's saying, and He's saying the Word of God, if it's not what Jesus is ministering, what Father has declared, you shut it down. And if you're not willing to do it, it's nothing to do with Father.
Amen.
It has to do with us. I will not be sad because He made me glad.
Amen.
Somebody said, I want to feel glad. Just be glad and you'll feel glad. Amen.
Amen.
Huh? I will not be condemned, for I have been given the ministry of peace. And it rules my heart and my mind. I won't allow it anything. I won't allow anything else.
Hallelujah.
Won't allow. Because if you do, it will ultimately become an oppressive evil spirit. But I tell you, the greatest power of deliverance is repentance.
Amen.
Devils have to leave at our word. When I speak, if devils got to go. So same with you. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. You know, I'm reminded of a story that I heard a man of God tell. And I can't remember the preacher. The preacher was a pretty famous preacher. I can't remember his name right now. Seems like it was Brother Campbell. I'm trying to remember his name. I'm pretty sure it was Brother Campbell. But at any rate, he was dying of tuberculosis. It was advanced case of tuberculosis. He was bedridden. He couldn't move. His back, in the 30s. Everybody prayed for him. Wigglesworth prayed for him. Ritchie Brothers prayed for him. Great men of God. Great men of God. Everybody. It was great men of faith. He grew worse. Mary prayed for him. And he was dying. He was in the bed. He was dying. And he looked out across and he could see out one window, and he could see as the story's told, he could see his wife and I believe it was his sister-in-law. They were out doing laundry on the scrub board, hanging it on the line. He could see out another window where they had him laying there. And he could see a tree way off in the field. And he thought, if I just had enough strength to get up, I could go out there and I could lay down under that tree and I could just begin to cry out to God there. And if I die, I die. It just looked like a good spot. He said, but if I could just get enough strength, I know I just feel in my spirit I could get a hold of God. And he miraculously got enough strength because he hadn't walked for days, like weeks. And he got up and he made it all the way out there. And he said, Lord, all these great men have prayed for me. Everybody they prayed for got healed. And here I am, and I've been your minister, and I've faithfully preached for you all these years. And here I am, I'm dying. He was dealing with all these assailing thoughts. And all of a sudden, the Lord said, just spoke to you real simple in the spirit, said, I've already done it. He just began to say, I receive what you've done. I receive, and it started off faint, and he could barely even get his hands up. Because by the time he got out there, it was even worse. He was even that much more pathetic and collapsed. He got his hands up a little bit. I receive what you've done. I receive what you've done. And before long, he's jumping around, dancing around. It's just really... Yeah. It really is that simple. He went around telling the story all over the United States of America. Receiving faith. I receive what you've done. Somebody waiting for a lightning bolt from heaven instead of looking at the word who came down from heaven and the price he paid at Calvary and the power and the authority of the resurrection and the great anointing released when he poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. So what's happening? What's wrong?
Just being too
pretty. No more chest pain.
No more chest pain. No more chest pain.
Oh, stress and anxiety. Oh, fear and torment. You lost your hold upon the servant of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You lost your hold.
Amen.
Upon the servant of the Lord. Jesus. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Sembra fatto la mo così frata sia. Ha 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 ha. Ha. Enemy na con rigana. Ha. Now that you know what's on the inside, huh? And what's on the outside, you can wage a good warfare. Huh? Huh? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Eristam brushele kiste. Mem brushele mondamondania. And you can increase, and you can grow, hallelujah, and you can develop,
yes.
Hallelujah. Hamanebra, ustili andafeya, inamongaraneya, ha ha, into every dimension of faith and power, ushilana, ikaromunishika. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for the signs and the wonders that are working on your mind, Holy Spirit. Ephros. Thank you, Jesus. Well, walk in the Spirit, live by the Word, be full of faith because you're full of God, and have a bunch of fun. Find a bunch of people, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. Worship the Lord with your giving. Amen. Run towards the offering basket. Watch God work a miracle for you. My mother said, My mother said, you can't outgive God. If anybody comes up with a deficit, I'll make up for God's lack. Listen and tell you right now, everybody in this place tonight received a miracle. Some of you might have to wait a while to discover it, but I promise you, you received a miracle. Miracle power of Jesus Christ. He is here, and He did His work. He's not slack on the job. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Let's hand on, dear. Oh, thank you so much. I love you so much.